We're going to start out talking about the afterlife here. Very important topic. It's part of the firewall of defensiveness that keeps us deluded, keeps us in trauma as we transit from the life in the world into the life of the body mind into the life of the afterlife. We believe, this is our reward, this is great, this is heaven, etc. What we find out later is that we are then told at some point that God wants to raise us higher. And the way that to be raised higher is to love God's creation more. And the way to do that is to go back into identifying with a body mind in the world, where the body mind suffers even more severe trauma, suffering, and misery. And we're told that this then will lift us up into an even higher relationship with God in the afterlife. Okay. And these cycles continue on and on and on and on and on. And it is a complete, total scam. It is maybe the heart of the firewall. Because what I've found is most people in this world are putting their faith in happiness and in the afterlife. I guess about, 78% of Americans believe in the afterlife or believe in heaven. Heaven meaning the afterlife. Of course there's an afterlife. But this afterlife is merely part of the dream of belief. Okay, it is not reality at all. It is still a complete denial of reality. Sure, our belief transits from identifying with the body mind to identifying with the afterlife. And so we may find ourselves in a beautiful afterlife and say, this is so wonderful. But at some point, we are told we need to identify with the body mind again when we may say, no, I don't want to leave this place. And then we are told various excuses by belief. And basically, it's that God is giving us an incredible opportunity to rise even higher in the creation, even higher. And we haven't yet learned to love God enough. And God wants this for us, and we have to do it. And if we, say, no, I don't want to, well, we will find that one way or another, we're going to be induced labor, meaning we will be induced back into the labor of the body mind and the trauma associated with that. The afterlife is not reality at all. That is not what when we're talking about awakening to truth, to going beyond belief. We're going beyond the afterlife as well. See, this whole world, the afterlife and this planet and all that is not the creation of the Prime Creator. Not at all. It is the imagination of belief. It's a belief system. So we're not learning to love by identifying with the body mind. We're learning to try and find out, we're attempting to find a way to threaten reality, actually. By identifying with what is vulnerable, we're working on the issue of vulnerability. And when we're identifying with the body mind, we have to try and find ways to protect it because it's vulnerable. Super vulnerable. I mean, if we can't get the food we need, the body mind, is going to die. It's going to transit to the afterlife. So when we're told that we need to leave our, afterlife abode and identify with the body mind again, it means that we need to get back to work on building defenses, finding a way to protect, and then that gives then the destructive aspect of belief something to work on also, which is to work on trying to get past those defenses and traumatizing and destroying the body mind, which is the real goal of both the life and afterlife, the body mind, flesh body mind, and the afterlife of the flesh body mind. All of that is one belief system, one purpose, to try and engineer a way to threaten and destroy reality, engineer a new power, a power of destructivity. And the way that it's done is this ceaseless identification with vulnerability. The body is simply a tool. It is a tool of vulnerability. It's just a prop that gets us to try to come up with ways to defend it, which then gives destructivity something to work on. If we didn't come up with any defenses for the body, and we had no interest in bodies whatsoever, then this destructivity, this experimental attempt to figure out how to breach those defenses, wouldn't have anything to work on. So we don't really like, you know, defensiveness and vulnerability and all of that. That's kind of like the price we have to pay to try and become prime creator. That is what the price we're paying, trying to pay. And we keep paying it over and over and over and over and over, and we don't get any, you know, payback. The payback we get is, quote unquote, the afterlife. The afterlife is always temporary, and we always get moved back into, again, identifying with vulnerability. So the going beyond belief, the unconditional love, that's not the afterlife. That can be experienced right now. Either now or any moment in the afterlife, it can be experienced now. It's going beyond the afterlife. It's seeing through the realizing that the afterlife and life are one and the same goal, one and the same scheme to try and figure out a way to threaten reality and force the prime creator to change reality and make a spirit prime creator. Because spirit can't change reality. And spirit believes that, well, prime creator created reality, must be able to change it. But no, prime creator created reality as unchangeable. So even the prime creator cannot change reality. And reality cannot be threatened. It cannot be changed. There's no agent that can change it. Not even the prime creator can change it. So all our efforts to figure out a way to threaten reality, threaten the prime creator, saying, you must change this, is futile. So all this identification with vulnerability and then building defenses to protect the vulnerable and then giving this is a setup for then destructivity to come in and figure out a way to destroy it. It's all a waste of time. We're just spinning our wheels. Just spinning our wheels. So don't put your faith in the afterlife. Is there an afterlife? Of course. Of course. It's like the R&R from, you know, it's kind of like the reward for identifying with vulnerability and putting up all sorts of defenses and experiencing all sorts of trauma. It's the reward for that. And how do you, and then after you get that reward, what happens? You get sent again, redeployed, redeployment. It's just like in a war where you're deployed and then you get a break and you get go to an R&R place, rest and relaxation. That's your reward for your, you know, vigorous activity in the war zone. And then you get redeployed back to the war zone again. It's exactly what happens. So of course people talk about the afterlife and they say, oh, you know, I died and all this light, all this kind of stuff. Yeah, sure. All sorts of situations arise in the afterlife. Just rest and relaxation is what it is. And then you get redeployed. You are a guilt trip is laid upon you, saying you don't love God enough yet, and therefore God is insisting you redeploy here. And it's used in different ways. One can say you're going to be even raised up to a higher level in the afterlife if you redeploy. And if you don't want to redeploy, you're told that God insists upon it because you're not loving God enough. You don't, you know, the idea of resisting redeployment, you're told that this is a sign that you don't really love God, and you're resisting loving God, and therefore you're a bad person. You have no choice but to work on that. God's insisting upon it. All nonsense. That all comes from belief. That is entirely the words of belief. Belief is putting words into the prime creator's mouth. The prime creator is not saying any of that whatsoever. Prime creator is saying, choose a new causal agent, choose a new idea, experience unconditional love, and accept reality as it is, which is total inclusiveness. You're always included in reality. You have full powers and scope of reality and endless, expansive experiencing and delight with no vulnerability, no death, no sickness, no suffering, no deployment to any war zone, no threats whatsoever. So this is extremely important firewall, because we're all thinking here that, well, if we just, you know, go through this turmoil and trauma that's to come, we will get a higher place in the afterlife. And if we resist it, we're going to get a very low place in the afterlife. But how about skipping the afterlife altogether? You see, you know, what do I care for a place in the afterlife? The afterlife is still just death. It's just a different phase of death, a different phase of trauma, a phase of vulnerability, where we're resting up to regather the nerve to, again, be subjected or be identified with even some severe, more severe trauma, more severe disappointment, suffering, more misery, as we identify with something we believe that's valuable. We defend this value, something that's valuable, that's vulnerable, valuable vulnerability is what we identify with. We'll keep identifying with what we see is even more valuable and vulnerable, valuable vulnerability, and then having these defenses breached, we'll find that, you know, our defenses are not sufficient, and they get breached, and we think, oh my gosh, it seems like we cannot protect valuable. See, and we're trying to build this belief up until this belief becomes a power. Belief is going to become a power, a real power, to threaten reality. And we keep on, we're trying to build it up by continually identifying with a valuable vulnerability. And, you know, we this goes on and on and on. And we may, you know, what keep identifying, you know, with something that's greater and greater, seem of greater and greater value within belief that's vulnerable, and then try to protect that. We might one day become, you know, be identified with a planet. And, of course, as we see, planet Earth is being destroyed. In other words, so that which is identifying as with planet Earth is undergoing this unbelievable trauma right now, extreme trauma, right? Because and they believe that which is identifying with Earth, that they're going to get a super high position in the afterlife, you know, close to God, as from going through this incredible trauma. Because imagine if your identity, if you were identifying with planet Earth right now, and the incredible trauma to the every aspect of planet Earth right now. Not to mention the ceaseless dying of everything on planet Earth, and the ceaseless rotting, decomposing of everything that dies on planet Earth, and just this non-stop pillaging that's going on planet Earth, extinction, destruction of the oceans, of the atmosphere, and all that, you know, it's just unbelievable, right? Imagine the trauma. So that's your reward. If you keep on with this, you getting identifying with larger and larger trauma, worse and worse trauma. In the belief that this is going to raise you higher and higher and higher up in the afterlife, after the trauma. This is all the grand scheme of delusion, of belief, of spirit trying to become prime creator. That's all that it is. And we don't have to continue on with that. Right now we're identifying with the human vulnerability. Valuable vulnerability of humanness. But later on, if we keep on with this, we'll identify with something other than humanness, something that is maybe seems, we believe, is more valuable vulnerability. You know, eventually maybe identify with a planet or a solar system or even a galaxy. You know, it goes on and on and on. And yet we don't have to do any of that. That's all entirely a waste of time. Total waste of time. You can see through it. At any point, we can see through it. Because all of this is just a setup to to give rise to defensiveness, and that so that these defenses can be breached, because we're trying to figure out how does reality defend itself from attack, from threat, because we in order to fulfill the desire of being prime creator, we have to find a way to force the prime creator to change reality. And prime creator was not responding at all to what we're doing, and so we're trying to threat, you know, when there's no response, we're trying to force the change by saying, look, what you love is reality, so we're going to destroy reality unless you change it. So we're trying to figure out how to destroy reality, and we can't figure it out, so we believe there must be some super protection that reality has, and we're trying to figure out how to get past that protection, how to destroy that, you know, protectiveness. And that's why, so we're simulating this protectiveness. Existence simulates this protectiveness, that we're believing that maybe this is it. We don't know what the protectiveness is of reality. We don't know. No one's figured it out. Why? Because there is none. How do you figure out what isn't there? How can you say what is there when it's not there? You see, that is the problem. So we keep simulating what we believe might be there as far as the protectiveness of reality. And since there isn't any protectiveness of reality, the simulations are infinite, because none of them work. None of them are really relevant. And so we try to arrive at quality. But there is no quality to arrive at, because reality has no defensiveness. But belief just says, well, let's just simulate, you know, trillions and trillions and quadrillions of vulnerability and defensiveness, protectiveness. Let's just simulate all this situation of protectiveness, and then let's penetrate that protectiveness and destroy that which this protectiveness was protecting. And maybe that these simulations will eventually coalesce into knowing what the protectiveness of reality is all about, and being able to then penetrate and get past that protectiveness and actually threaten reality. That is what the entire system of body, mind, and the afterlife, life in the afterlife, or you call it death in the afterlife, whatever you want to call it, the entire situation serves that one purpose. Now, those who are really gung-ho on this, they may find that once the body-mind dies, they'll find themselves reincarnated, boom, very quickly. And those who really don't like this at all, they say, wow, I never want to do this again. They may find themselves dwelling in the afterlife for a long time, as guilt and this whole thing keeps working on gradually pulling them back through guilt, back into, through fear, back into identifying again with specific vulnerabilities, valuable vulnerabilities. So even if you could dwell in the afterlife for, you know, thousands of years, it doesn't mean you're free at all from delusion, not at all. And you could find yourself right back here, right back identifying with some valuable vulnerability, some believed in valuable vulnerability, and then finding yourself, that valuable vulnerability, becoming undone. Everything gradually going wrong, you know, getting sick, wearing out, collapsing, struggling, failing, suffering, and then desperate measures to keep going. And then you realize that there's something just witnessing all this. You know, there's a witness of all this. What is that? There's two witnesses. That there's the witness of all of this is simply belief harvesting data from the situation. It's noticing, okay, there's a pitfall. You almost were destroyed, but you found some way to protect yourself. And then what kind of protection did you use, and then how did that get attacked? And it's simply harvesting all this data. And then there's another witness of all this, which is what you truly are looking, just wanting all this to be true, waiting and wanting for all this to be true. And it's this witness of the witnessing of this that is the one who has to choose a new idea. So there is this like kind of felt presence of that we have that is simply harvesting all the data that is going on. Sort of like an impersonal harvester of all data. But that is not our true identity at all. Not at all. But we believe it is, and we believe maybe that's God. Maybe that's our true identity. It is not. It is that which is collecting all of the information about penetrating vulnerability so that it can somehow stitch together all this, crunch the numbers, and come up with an answer. So we assume this is God, that this witnessing, observing quality, we assume that that is our salvation, that we're waiting for that to save us. It is not God. That is not our salvation. That is just the data harvester and the number cruncher who is supposed to collect all this data from all this breaching of vulnerability, this penetration of vulnerability, all this protectiveness, the penetration of all this protectiveness, and then wreaking havoc on what it's protecting, is supposed to put all that together and then come up with a power. And then we believe that power will save us. So we're trying to manufacture a God, manufacture a power to then use against the true prime creator and threaten that true prime creator with the destruction of reality. So this God that we believe in is just a harvester of data and the number cruncher, the one who suppose has the genius to put it all together. No such genius, because reality doesn't have any defenses. It's not threatened. There's no power to threaten it. No power can ever come about to threaten it. So there's no need. All this data harvesting and number crunching is complete waste of time. It's not God that's doing that. It's belief that's doing that. And belief is just the play of mind in the service of presenting the idea of wanting to be prime creator. That's all that it is. So it's very important to talk about these big topics that are maybe shocking to people. You know, most people have this faith in the afterlife, like, all I have to do is die and I'm saved. Nothing can be further from the truth. Because we're in the afterlife, we're just expecting this number cruncher, data harvester, number cruncher to succeed and give us, you know, eternal life. And of course, that number cruncher says, well, I'm almost there, and I just need for you to do one little favor for me, and then we'll have it. And how can you resist that, you know? You may be up in a very high place of the afterlife and really relaxing. It's all this beautiful. And then this number cruncher data harvester will come to you and say, you know what? I'm just a tiny bit short of the answer. There's just one little piece missing, and you're the one who can supply this little missing piece. And by doing it, you're going to save everyone. Because once I get the power, no one has to suffer anymore. They'll never have to be born anymore. We'll then be able to get what we really want. And of course, it never tells you what that is, but it really is to be able to threaten reality with destruction and force the prime creator to change reality and make spirit prime creator. That is what we believe will make us happy. But by choosing the idea of wanting to be prime creator, a desire arises, because we can't experience this idea. So unfulfilled desire arises, and we want that desire to be fulfilled. So you will be told, you are the one who, if you go into the world and suffer all the severe trauma, that you will literally save everyone from any more trauma. You will be told that, which is a, and so you will, how can you resist? Because you think, my gosh, how selfish of me to say no to that. Whereas if I do it, I'm going to save everyone. And if I don't do it, everyone's going to continue to suffer eternally. How can you resist that guilt? How, you see? And that is the question we have to answer. And we can resist that guilt. It's totally bogus. 100% bogus. The whole story of Jesus, that the way that's been presented by belief, is this story of so-called God saying, you know what, I'm just short of one supreme suffering trauma, and I need you to go down into the world and suffer extreme trauma, and by doing that, that'll complete this project, this mission. It'll and then nobody else will ever have to suffer. I promise. And so that is the story we've been told, and that is exactly the story that we need to see through as completely bogus. As far, God, the Prime Creator, would never ever say such a thing. Ask someone to suffer to complete something. Nonsense. That is the big lie. Okay, and so I'm not saying Jesus didn't come into the world or anything like that, but I'm saying the way that belief has been telling the story can, you know, is complete distortion. It is the very thing we have to see through, because the reality has no defense. And the idea that the guilt is saying that you, that this data crunching and data collecting, data crunching, number crunching, will always tell you that you, when you resist it to the ultimate, it will say, ah, you have the key to saving everyone, because this is almost complete, the project's almost complete. So if you just go in the world, identify with a super valuable vulnerability, and then that'll enable destructivity to find a way to penetrate that protection. And in finding how to penetrate that protection, then we will have the power to threaten God, and we'll be able to force God to change reality, and then all fear will vanish and we'll be happy. Completely delusional. And so we say, oh, wow. Again, it's like the ultimate guilt trip. It is the ultimate guilt trip, and that is exactly what we need to see through, which is what I'm doing, and I'm telling you it can be seen through. And I'll just say, ah, no way. That is completely insane. That saying that you're almost finished accomplishing the impossible is completely insane. Fact is that this data collection and number crunching aspect of the dream, of belief, has not even taken the first tiny micro step towards anything. So saying that it's almost complete and just needs one more little piece, and that piece is you, and you're, and by you doing the complying with this request, you're going to end up saving everybody from any more trauma, is totally insane. It's the very essence of insanity. And so what you need to say is no. And maybe that's what Jesus was telling us, you know, is this is the dynamic. Perhaps Jesus was pointing out that this is the big dynamic of what happens. And I'm here to free you, to show you the big dynamic and free you. The notion that there's a God in the afterlife that will send his most beloved son down into the world in order to be crucified, you know, is the whole dynamic of belief, this insanity that you have to see through. This guilt trip that where belief lays upon itself, saying, you have the key to saving everyone from any more trauma by putting on the ultimate in protection and having the ultimate in value, and then allowing the penetration of that protectivity to take place, and the destruction of what was seen as ultimate value, that is going to then complete the puzzle. And once the puzzle is completed, then no more identification with vulnerability, right? We all be over, because we'll be able to force the Prime Creator to change reality. That's exactly what the whole passion play of Christ was pointing out to us. Was pointing out the dynamic that is at work, not just in this world, but in the afterlife, and why we get sent into this world through this guilt trip. And I've never heard it explained this way, but it just occurred to me, you know, at this moment to explain it that way. It's very true. It's very true. You know, it's outing this entire dynamic of belief. And we might wonder, you know, how is it we keep getting sent, you know, to re-identify with vulnerability and all this? Because we are told that our part in this plan is essential. That if we don't do our part in this plan, the whole thing will collapse. We're always told that. That our part is essential. So that's a complete guilt trip. In other words, if we don't do our part by identifying with valuable vulnerability and enabling destructivity to come in and penetrate that protection, that somehow, if we fail in doing that, the entire situation will fail. So every one of us has this guilt trip laid upon us. It's a total guilt trip. It's basically saying that everyone else's suffering is dependent, is in your hands, and that if you don't accept your suffering, the whole plan of salvation from suffering is going to fail, and then everybody will suffer eternally for that, eternal damnation, eternal suffering for everyone. That is the guilt trip that is laid on every single one of us. And it seems like an impossible guilt trip to deal with, right? It's not impossible, because we're doing it right here. We're seeing through the situation right here. It's such an intense guilt trip that most of us just simply say, oh my gosh, you know, I don't want everybody's suffering to be my fault forever. And so we don't even question it. We just go along with identifying, protecting valuable vulnerability, protecting it, and then having that protection attacked. And then this observer observing all this and calling this all this data, and then trusting that it'll come up with a power. It'll put it all together, and it'll manufacture this power. It'll put it together. It's like it's assembling this super weapon against reality and to succeed. But our part, our little part in this super weapon, is like all essential. It's like a little widget, you know, little screw, little ball bearing, something. And that we're told that our part is totally essential. And we think, wow, you know, I'm playing an essential part in the success of salvation. Not at all. Salvation is extremely simple. Simply choose a new idea. That's the only way anyone is ever going to be saved. Simply choose the idea of not wanting to be prime creator, not desiring, not insisting on changing reality, changing what is, accepting what is, the idea of accepting reality as it is. That is salvation. It has nothing to do with guilt. From accepting that idea, unconditional, seamless, endless, flawless love overlays all guilt, all trauma, all belief, everything, the sense of everything simply at rest as it is, arises. No guilt there. So we're heading into a situation where everybody is ready to play their part, believing that is their salvation. In other words, play their part, meaning enable the defense, the protectivity that they have to be penetrated, and the walls to collapse, and the whole thing to come tumbling down. And they're go on it because they see that as their salvation. Total insanity. Total insanity. It's impossible for the Prime Creator to ask any suffering to take place, because it's impossible in reality for any suffering to take place. Nothing in reality can be threatened in any way. It's absolutely non-threatenable, invulnerable completely. And there can be no suffering whatsoever, and there can be never can be. Reality is all inclusive. There can never be any request to so-called leave reality and suffer. That's impossible. What Jesus must have been doing is pointing out the totality of this dynamic that is at play, the totality of the guilt, the notion that there's some God that is insisting that his favorite, the one and only, most beloved son needs to come down identify with valuable vulnerability and have this protectivity out, and then have this protectivity breached and this body mind destroyed and all that, and that somehow then this is going to then save everyone because the answer of how to threaten and destroy reality has now been found, all of that. And Jesus was just pointing that out to us, saying this is how belief is working, and this is completely insane. Who knows, after the resurrection, who knows what he may have been said, you know, and may have been pointed out. Maybe Jesus said, you know, hey, do you get it? You know, do you get it? Do you see what this, you know, was showing you? So when you go in the afterlife, you see through the whole thing, the whole dynamic of belief, and not keep being played for a fool. And when belief comes to you and lays this guilt trip on you and says that the entirety of salvation depends on you playing your role, and that only you can do it, and you're going to save everybody from any more trauma, you can see through that and say, no, I'm going to choose a new idea. And of course, belief will say, oh, how selfish, you're the most incredibly selfish entity, pure selfishness, because you're here, you're going to be dwelling in reality and bliss, and you could have been saving everybody by your suffering. How can you be so unbelievably selfish? All nonsense. Because what you'll do is you will choose a new idea, experience unconditional love, and then you can show that to others if you choose. You can show that choosing a new idea is salvation, and show them the real way to salvation instead of the way that can never work, which is simply more and more trauma, endless trauma, cycles, endless cycling in and out of severe traumas. And nonstop guilt, nonstop guilt, guilt, vulnerability, you know, trying to get rid of this guilt by subjecting, you know, identifying with, engaging with vulnerability and trauma, and then having guilt laid upon you again because it didn't work, hasn't worked yet, and then being told that it's one little more piece is all that it takes and you're it, and being told you have to then go back and go through even incredible trauma, which I have in my life, unbelievable trauma, nonstop trauma, in subtle ways, just you know, like pure trauma. And I said that it's completely bogus. Saw through the entire situation. It's totally bogus. The whole thing, whole belief system, the afterlife, and identifying with vulnerability, the guilt trip that drives the whole thing. Whole thing being driven by guilt. You being told that you're failing everyone if you don't do your part of trauma and vulnerability. Nothing but a lie. Nothing but delusion. Choosing a new idea is the only way, a new causal agent is the only way, because then no more belief. Belief doesn't even arise. So you don't have to come to terms with belief at all. Belief simply doesn't arise anymore for you. And its place is unconditional love. You don't have to answer to belief at that point. There isn't any more belief. Belief is a delusional system. Belief, believing, and belief. It has no awareness of truth or reality whatsoever. Never will. It's just complete madness. We're told that, you know, because Jesus died, that we're saved. In other words, Jesus was supposed to be reality, and then reality was killed. And so we figure, okay, we now know how to destroy reality. So if we just accept this, and believe that we have the power to destroy reality, we're going to be saved because we're going to be able to force the prime creator to change reality for us and make us prime creator. Now, that is totally delusional. It's not, that is a delusional notion of salvation. Salvation comes from choosing a new idea, different causal agent, which have different effects. The idea of accepting reality as it is gives rise to unconditional love. Doesn't give rise to any attempt to threaten reality. Doesn't give rise to any attempt to change reality. Doesn't give rise to any guilt that you need to figure out to allow your engage with vulnerability and the attack of vulnerability, and doesn't give rise to any of that. The fact that Jesus reached out with A Course in Miracles and set the record straight about the whole passion play and crucifixion, all that kind of stuff, it was very helpful, because I knew, he said, "Now this is bogus. This is guilt. What is that? It's nuts." He said, "Yeah, it's been distorted. It's been twisted. It hasn't been put in the right context. That what was going on was a depiction of belief. What belief is up to? Believing in all this stuff. Believing in a false plan of salvation." And Jesus is showing us this is the false plan of salvation, so we could see it, and then contrast that with the true plan of salvation. How could a loving God, you know, keep subjecting us to all this vulnerability? It's a made up, make believe scenario entirely. This entire situation, life and the afterlife, is a make believe, made up scenario, hypothetical scenario. And so, what is most relevant is to be able to resist that guilt, to say no to that guilt trip. Existence is just a guilt trip. It is nothing more than a guilt trip. And the afterlife is just part of that guilt trip, where you rest a little bit before you're sent back into more trauma. Where you experience the real teeth of guilt. In this world, we're so engaged with protecting vulnerability, we don't really feel the guilt so much. It's in the afterlife that we get the guilt trip laid on us most severely, because we're told we have to go back and engage with vulnerability and protecting that, and we don't want to go, and that's when the guilt gets laid on us. So if we really want to get free of the cycles, endless cycles of birth, death, and the afterlife, and we really need to really focus on the afterlife and the guilt trip that's laid upon us there. And we can do that right while we're here. We don't need to wait until the body mind, you know, dies. We literally can do that while we're engaged here in this world. We can look at the afterlife, and we can say no to the afterlife, as it were, the guilt trip, which is just a guilt trip there. Some rest and then a guilt trip. And the more we resist, the more severe the guilt trip becomes. And I didn't want to come back here at all. I had a very severe guilt trip laid on me. That's why I'm aware of this, how severe the guilt trip can become. If you really resist, you will eventually end up being told. What happens is, and I'll let you in on this, it's very important. Belief will whisper in your ear. You think it's God whispering in your ear. It's not. It's belief. And belief will whisper in your ear, and they'll say, "You know what? I didn't want to tell you this, but I have something very important to tell you." I will tell you. And he'll say, "You know what? You're actually the chosen one, and you're the one that I've chosen. I didn't want to tell you this because, you know, it's so important, but I have to tell it you now because you're resisting, you know. But you're actually the chosen one. You need to go back into the world, and through your suffering and misery, your trauma, you're going to save everybody. And you will set everybody free, and you will be the Savior. I didn't want to tell you, but I'm telling you now." And you say, "Oh my gosh, I didn't know that. Really? Is that so?" And it gradually works on you, and before you know it, boom, you've gone back, and you're trying to protect vulnerability here, engaging with that. That's what happens. So you need to get to the point, we all do, where when belief whispers in our ear, we can just say, no, I know exactly what you're up to, belief. There is no chosen one. How can someone be chosen to accomplish the impossible? How can there be a chosen one of what can never take place. It's ludicrous, isn't it? From the standpoint of reason, it's completely ludicrous. So when belief, you know, whispers that in your ear, you can just say, get behind me, Satan, you know, get behind me, belief. Get out of my ear, you know. I'm going to choose a new idea. And where, you know, this whispering in my ear of belief, it won't arise at all. So you do really need to get past this whole savior notion of belief's idea of a savior. You have to get past that. You have to free yourself from that. That you are not that. Nobody is that. No one will ever be the savior to make belief's plan of salvation work. It's an unworkable plan. Completely unworkable. In other words, it's a zero. It is totally futile from the very beginning. So how can there be someone who comes along and makes it possible? Never will be. So there won't ever be a savior. No, no one. Never. Not a savior of belief's plan within belief's plan. Never. The salvation comes from rejecting belief's plan and choosing what plan really works, which is choosing a new idea. That's the plan that actually works. And everybody will do that. So everybody will save themselves, as it were. The aspect of spirit, which is engaging with belief, will do that. And then all other aspects will see that and realize they're included in that too. And they'll realize, hey, I want to choose a new idea also. This is salvation. And they'll drop the belief's plan. But in order to drop belief's plan, we do have to be able to resist that guilt and dismiss that guilt trip, the ultimate guilt trip. We have to dismiss it. Otherwise, for certain, we will be re-engaging with trying to protect vulnerability and experience massive trauma and believe that we're doing some essential role, carrying out some essential role that is going to help save everybody. That will happen. That will happen. Absolutely will happen if we don't reject the ultimate guilt trip, the very essence of guilt, which is somehow we're being told that our part is essential. If we don't do our part, will cause everybody else to fail. But yet nobody can fail to choose a new idea. That option is always right here and right now, never off the plate. So nobody can ever fail to be saved. It's impossible. Everyone will choose a new idea. So you can't cause anybody to fail, not even the slightest bit. No one can cause anybody else to fail to be saved. It's impossible. Because reality is, choosing a new idea is always right here now. The option will always be that way, and we have the capability to choose a new idea always, and the effects of that idea will be exactly the same always. Unconditional love, able to fail at that, no guilt. As far as salvation, you know, there can't be any guilt. Nobody can prevent someone else from choosing a new idea in no way. Now, the way to encourage them is to do it ourselves. We can't give something to someone we don't first have for ourselves, right? If we want to share it, we have to have it ourselves first. We can't share with others what we don't already have, you know? If we want to sing a song and share it with everyone, we have to know what the song is, right? The song of salvation, if we want to share it, we have to have it, accept it for ourselves first. And so we have to reject guilt first. We have to reject guilt. The guilt is from belief, and it is totally delusional. And again, we get this guilt trip in the afterlife, which is why you might be listening to this and saying, well, I can't quite relate to this, because what does this have to do with, you know, life, living here, you know, protecting my life here? It has everything to do with getting free from endless cycling, over and over and over and over and over, identifying, trying to protect vulnerability. That's what it has to do with. Because what you're protecting, body, mind, passes away, you will find yourself in the afterlife. And eventually you will find a guilt trip getting laid upon you, saying, hey, tap on the shoulder, hey, it's time for you to carry out your essential part. And you'll say, wait a minute, I already carried out my essential part. That's what happened to me. I carried out what I believe was an essential part. I was in the afterlife. I got a tap on the shoulder and says, you need to go back to the world. I said, no. I already carried out my essential part. You told me that this life I just finished was the essential to help salvation. And I did it. I did a great job. And that's it. And now you're telling me I need to go back? And I said, no way. So I resisted that. And then the ultimate guilt trip got laid on me, you know, like, hey, you know, we didn't want to tell you this, but your role is like, you know, the key role, you know, you're the starring role. Now you know, and if you don't do that, nobody will ever be saved. The whole thing will collapse and fail. So, you know, being unable to resist that brought me, you know, back here and suffered just nonstop trauma my whole life. So I was not able to resist that ultimate, you know, so-called charge that belief plays. But at this point, I can resist it. So the afterlife for me is going to be a different story, because it I probably will, you know, I don't know how things will go, but that tap on the shoulder and saying you need to go back and carry out your essential role is going to be dismissed. Going to be dismissed. It's over. So how the afterlife plays out for me, I don't know. Even if there's going to be an afterlife for me, I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe just unconditional love, by choosing a new idea, unconditional love will rise, and then awareness of my, you know, perfect inclusiveness in inclusion in reality will take place. But I'm not really even worried about that at all. What is germane to the situation is being able to dismiss that ultimate guilt trip. And it can also do it like a team thing, like say, hey, we got this team. We've set up this salvation team. And you have a super important role to play in the salvation team. And you say, no. And then belief will say, well, I didn't want to tell you this, but you're actually the head of this salvation team. And then you say, oh, really? Say, yeah, there's all these really great helpers, light workers, and you'll be able to come to the world, and you're going to you'll save everybody, and trauma will be ended for everyone. And you say, wow, okay, I guess I better do this. Again, fooled again. Belief is the great deceiver, the great fooler. We fool ourselves over and over because we want the goal that belief is showing us how to reach. We want it to be true. We want to reach that goal. We want to be prime creator. And so we believe there's a means. If we want it to be prime creator, we have to believe there's a means. Otherwise, we drop the idea. If we didn't believe there's a means, how could we entertain this idea? We would say, there's no means to ever experience this. So how could we hold on to this idea? We couldn't. We'd have to drop it. We'd say, there's no means to experience it. So it's futile. We'd drop it like that. So we believe there's a means. So we believe that this trauma, this protecting of vulnerability and then having that protection penetrated and destroyed and the trauma inflicted, we believe that is going to, by calling the data, crunching the numbers, putting it all together, is going to result in a super weapon to threaten reality with and force prime creator to change reality. We believe this will happen, and it will not happen. It is simply belief. God knows it will never happen. Reality knows it will never happen. So we're simply believing that it will happen. And so we keep on accepting this guilt trip. We're told that this guilt is essential. It's essential guilt that we're reluctant to, it's kind of saying, well, we're reluctant to finish the job because some kind of attachment to reality or something. So we need this guilt to keep, you know, pushing us to do our part. Again, what part can we play within futility, within impossibility? What part can we really play? No part at all. We've never played any role whatsoever in any success in existence. No one will ever play any role of success. Zero. Success is already within everyone, choosing a new idea. It's the same for everyone. And we didn't set that up. That reality set that up. So we're not playing any role in that, really. Other than simply reminding one another that this is so, but we didn't set it up. We didn't give ourselves the capacity to choose it. Prime Creator did. We didn't give ourselves reality. Prime Creator created reality. We didn't give ourselves the ability to choose an idea, another idea. Prime Creator gave us that ability. So it's reality that saves us. Reality is already there. It's already established. We didn't establish reality. So simply accepting what is salvation, and reality already accepts what it is. But we need to go through the charade of, you know, choosing the idea of accepting reality as if we had some choice not to do. But as long as we believe, you know, that we do have a choice, then it seems relevant to make choice to accept reality as it is. But eventually we'll see that we never had a choice in the first place. We have no choice but to accept it as it is. Denial was a zero from the very beginning. So we're going after this situation like this in a very, very big picture way because of the troubles that are coming in this world, the trauma that is coming. See, everybody here is gung-ho wanting to do their role, to carry out their sacrifice, to provide the data to this observer so that the data can be crunched, put together, and we hope will finally result in this super weapon being operational against reality. And so everybody on this planet is so into their little essential part of, you know, being traumatized, that they're, you know, the whole thing is going to happen. I mean, how many here on this planet have been able to completely reject the ultimate guilt trip and see through that? How many? I don't know. Maybe a handful. Maybe two handfuls or a bushel or something. I don't know. Not much. Not out of 7 billion. You know, not much. Not many. So, the fact that that not being able to reject the ultimate guilt trip means everyone believes their situation, and they're not quite sure what it is, but it's actually being traumatized, is essential for the success of everybody else. You know, in other words, they need to do their part or else everybody else will fail. That is the guilt that we're under. That is what drives, that is the engine that drives belief, is that somehow if we don't do our part, everyone else is going to fail, which is a total lie. The truth is nobody can fail. Even if we delay endlessly, nobody can fail. Where is my mouse? Oh, it's stuck. Maybe because the battery is dead. I keep on recording indefinitely here because I cannot move the mouse. Oh my gosh. I cannot move the mouse to stop recording. It's not a touch screen. I can't, you know, touch the screen and stop the recording. So I don't know how to stop the recording. Get a new battery is what I'll have to do. Come on, no, I know how to do it. I can open up the battery care of the mouse and reinsert the battery, and that'll give me a little jolt, and I'll be able to go over and stop recording. Maybe we don't need to stop recording. Maybe we'll just keep on recording. This is so great that why not? Why not? Why be in a hurry to stop it? Because this is the best video I've ever done, for sure. The best. Because it got down to the nitty-gritty. We're talking about the afterlife. Talking about the guilt trip. Belief is just a guilt trip. That's all it is. And telling you, if you don't do your part, everyone else will fail. Total lie. 100% lie. Nobody can fail. Let's say you choose a new idea and you're in reality and you never come back to existence. No, that's not causing anyone's failure. Because we have within us the Holy Spirit, the divine reason, the reason of God, reason of reality. The advocate for reality is within everybody. So everybody, reason will show them, teach them from within the truth, as it has been with me. I haven't had a teacher here in this world. I mean, I haven't come across any teacher, external teacher in this world. I got it from reason within. Everybody has that. The choosing a new idea is always an option for everybody. Will always be there. And the results will always be the same for everyone. Everybody has reason within. Nobody is without it. So the idea that if you choose unconditional love, that somehow you're causing other people to fail is completely unfounded. Now, can delay be help? To a certain extent. To a certain extent, a small extent. But still, the goal is exactly the same, which is everyone has to choose a new idea and has to give up the plan of belief for salvation, which is guilt-based, which is sacrifice-based, which is trauma-based, which is delay-based, which is attack-based, which is threat-based. You have to, you know, give that up. Exchange that for God's plan of salvation, which is to choose a new idea. Has to be that way. Has to be that way. So, the times that are to come are times where everyone is doing what they feel being driven by guilt to do, is to do their essential part, which is to accept their own trauma. And, you know, we're at that time now. We're at that time. Which is why I'm saying, hey, no, I don't want to be part of this at all. I have no, has no relevance to me. Trauma has no relevance. It's amazing that when I allow my resolve to kind of take a brief vacation, what arises as thoughts within me now, and like I'm being shocked. It's shocking because super violent scenarios arise. Like what it starts out as like a theme for a movie. Like, hey, here's a nice script for a movie. You know, like a James Bond movie or something. And then all this super violent, terrible, traumatic stuff arises as if I'm storyboarding a movie. And I say, wow, where's that coming from? It's coming from belief. You see. Belief is storyboarding this all for everybody. Super violent stuff is coming. Super traumatic stuff is coming. And if you engage with belief, this is what arises right now. And I have to kind of say, whoa, no. It's amazing how trauma has been mainstreamed in the world. So that everybody is like so accepting of trauma. You look at stuff, you know, I see stuff on television, like watching the World Series, and you see these commercials. And it's just like I'm saying, my gosh, in my wildest dreams, could I even dream up such intense trauma and violence and acceptance of it? And here you, I mean, this is being shown to kids. I mean, who watches the World Series? Well, you know, baseball fans, but of all ages. Ton of young people, like up out of AT&T Park, the Giants ballpark. You know, the crowd is all the way children, young children, all the way up to old people. But, you know, it's not just all adults, you know. And even why would any adult want to be subject themselves to scenarios of such extreme violence and trauma? They don't. It's horrible. And that's just, you know, that's just being done, you know, casually. And no one's even commenting on it anymore. That just shows you how this sewage has backed up in the world and it's gotten to all our drinking supply, as it were. It's as if the entire sewage system of the world is stopped up and it's backed up and it's into our tap water now. We're showering in it, we're drinking it, and we've come to the point where we just accept the stench. You know, it's like before we go into like an outhouse. I remember my grandmother had this outhouse. We go visit her. She lived in a trailer. And we go visit her. And we have to use the outhouse. If we want to go to the bathroom, we have to go to the outhouse on the hill. And it was not properly maintained. It was just a pit in the ground. And they didn't put lime in it. They didn't, you know. And you go in there and the flies would be buzzing, the yellow jackets. And the stench would literally almost knock you out. And I said, I can't go to the bathroom. That's, you know, I got super constipated if I ever went to visit my grandmother because I refused to go to the bathroom. It was so terrible. And at some point you would have to, you know, and it would just be the most horrible thing. But she got completely used to it, no problem. It's like that in the world. when I see, you know, this violent stuff, it's abhorrent to me. And it's like, I have this reaction, like, I don't even want to watch the World Series. It's so terrible. I cannot stand this stuff at all. Whereas other people have gotten so used to it, it's like, oh, there's nothing. They're just watching it. Oh, this is cool. This is cool. You know, it's all these beings, like, tearing themselves limb from limb, you know. It's, you know, right there on the television, young people, old people, everyone is being subjecting themselves to that casually. Oh yeah, it's just a, you know, break in the game, and you know, okay, and there's a third out, and now we go to the monster movie where everyone is being torn to pieces, and okay, now we're back, and now here's the bottom of the sixth inning. It's like, oh, it's just casually being interwoven in our lives and what we really enjoy. I enjoy watching baseball, it's fun. Just casually being interwoven within that. So within our casual experiencing of what we enjoy in this world is this interweaving of super violence, super trauma has taken place over the last 50 years. To the point now where we feel that is part of what we enjoy. You know, hey, baseball game, sure. There's supposed to be a bunch of trauma also taking place, right? That's part of the game. It's become part of the game. Anything, any sporting event, anything we're watching now has these super violent commercials. Super decadent, super wicked stuff. And also hard liquor, you know, advertisements. Lots of hard liquor is being advertised to kids. Kids are watching this. And also, you know, very sexy commercials too. It's all interwoven. Sexiness, drugs, and super violence and super trauma is become interwoven, a tapestry with what we like to enjoy in our everyday life. And so we will, at some point, our everyday life will become super traumatic. And we'll stay with it by also trying to make it super sexy, too, and by taking all sorts of drugs, whatever, you know, whatever drugs people enjoy, think that they enjoy taking. The whole thing will be interwoven. Drugs, sex, violence, trauma. And it's become, it's now that a lot of people now feel that is life here. That's what the way it's supposed to be. We've been conditioned to expect that. You know, first of all, you know, through video games and movies and television and all this kind of stuff. And our consciousness, you know, this has all become interwoven. But I find that, you know, the slightest, like, news, like, you know, mom does this to children and then does this to herself, it's like abhorrent, completely abhorrent. I don't even want to think about it or see it. And every website you go to, a news article, you know, here comes the storm, Sandy is coming in, and they go down to the bottom, and then it says, recommended for you, or important news. Every bit of, you look at those news, it's super traumatic stuff, grotesque, heinous type of stuff, interwoven with some, you know, sexy news, you know, starlet this, starlet that. It gets all interwoven. So it keeps us being attracted to trauma. You might say, what have we been doing the last 50 years on the planet? Attracting ourselves towards trauma is what we've been doing. Using guilt and attractiveness towards trauma so that we do our part, quote unquote, our part to save everybody. That's what's been going on. And of course, those who play the sexy role, attractive role, you know, they believe they have to do this. That's their essential part. Otherwise, they're going to cause everybody to fail and suffer eternal damnation. They have to do this too, to attract everyone to trauma. So there's all these people in the world who their role is to attract others towards trauma. And they're doing it through guilt too. They feel guilty if they don't do it. Everyone is on a guilt trip here. Except those who have the clarity to see through the guilt trip. And those are few and far between. And the guilt trip has this trauma and attraction to trauma. And the interweaving. What about those who produce all these movies and produce all these advertisements, etc.? They're on a guilt trip too. They believe that they need to interweave trauma within what we're attracted to, interweave the two, so we are end up being attracted to trauma and accepting trauma and saying, yeah, this is what I really love, this is what I want, this is, I can't have this, you know, sexiness without the trauma. I have to have both of them. I can't have, you know, what I think I want and the trauma too goes together. we've associated what we, you know, happiness with trauma, that we can't have one without the other. This is done through, you know, using the sexiness of bodies to attract to the trauma. Yeah, you know, this is the same game. It's the same game as always being played. Belief is just doing the same old, same old, same old, same old, same old, you know. And the only reason why we keep going along with it is guilt, a guilt trip. That somehow, if we don't go along with this plan, we're going to cause the whole plan to fail for everybody, ourselves included, everyone, and that we'll be responsible, and everybody else will then blame it on us, blame the failure on us. Well, belief will blame the failure on us, but nobody, no spirit won't blame it. No, reality won't blame it. Reality is safe from blame. There's no blame in reality. Reality will say, all aspects of spirit can choose a new idea right now, always. If they're choosing not to, that's their own, you know, they're still wanting to find a way to change reality. So that's on them. It's not on you. It's not on anybody else. Each one of us, it's on us to find a way to change reality, then we are going to, you know, get caught up in this. And belief will tell us these lies. So the trauma is coming in this world. And everyone is attracting it to them. They're all they believe that they're going to get, that the sexiness of it all is going to outweigh the trauma of it. That is the big lie, isn't it? And they also believe that the afterlife, the reward of going through this trauma, is going to give them some incredibly wonderful afterlife. They're leaving out the part of return ticket through guilt trip, right? They're leaving that out. They're not dealing with that. They're not. You get all these books now. What's happening is you get close to severe trauma in the world, you start having all these books come out about the afterlife and how wonderful the afterlife is. What is that catering to? Of course it's catering to those who realize that they're soon going to have their lives soon going to be brutalized and die. And so, of course, they're focused on the afterlife. Well, what's the afterlife going to be like? You know, young people are paying attention to this. It used to be that only older people really paid much attention to the afterlife, because they figured they're headed there soon, so they better get religion, as it were, and get right with God, as it were, so they can get a nice place in the afterlife. But now, is everybody is focused on the afterlife. The young, the old alike, because the young realize they too are soon be transiting to the afterlife. Yeah, that's a fact. But what those books don't tell you is the guilt trip that will be laid at some point in the afterlife. Don't tell you that at all. So what those books really are doing is helping enable the trauma to take place, saying, hey, don't worry, once you go through the trauma, you'll be safe because the afterlife is there, and that'll be your true home. You'll be able to remain there forever. Because, you know, these teachings say that's your eternal home. The afterlife will be your eternal home. Not true. Not true. Belief will whisper in your ear at some point telling you that didn't quite succeed. Came up one step short, and you're that step. So go back in. Go back to the world. Re-identify with vulnerability and protect it as best you can. That's your role. Protect it as best you can. And then, of course, along will come trauma that will figure out a way to mess you up. Those books don't tell you that at all. Because they're being sponsored by belief. Because belief is saying, hey, everybody, go through the trauma. We need you to all go through trauma, or else the whole plan will collapse. How can the impossible have a plan that collapses? There was never any plan at all. I mean, there's never any possibility of success. So how can success collapse? How can zero collapse? Cannot. It cannot collapse. The plan of belief has zero possibility of success. None. So how can you ruin it for anybody? What, how can what can never even start be ruined? What is being ruined? How is zero being ruined? It's not being ruined. That is again just a lie of belief. Plausible nonsense. But again, most are jockeying for a higher position in the afterlife. You know, so what kind of, you know, what kind of glorious trauma and death can they go through that is most helpful to save everyone? And of course, for instance, if I were to sidestep the whole thing, for example, and not go through any death or trauma at all, of course, the guilt trip would try to lay that on me and saying, the reason why this all this trauma, everybody died in vain because you were selfish and you decided you didn't want to contribute your death to the whole situation. And that caused everybody else to fail. Belief will try to lay that guilt trip on me, guaranteed. It can't do anything but that. That's all that it's got. Guilt is all that it's got. And I'll just say, no, that's a complete lie. What we need to do, everyone, I'll tell everyone, choose a new idea, as I have been doing. So I say, I've not been harming anyone. I've been helping everyone, actually, because I've been sharing this with everyone. Now, the fact that not everyone is picking it up doesn't mean I'm not sharing it. I am sharing it. And even if I weren't doing videos, I'd still be sharing it because thoughts are shared with everybody intrinsically. This is just another form of sharing it, but my willingness to choose a new idea, my willingness to share the truth with everybody is there. So that is actually helping everyone. So I'm not hurting anyone, and I'm helping everyone by doing this. So belief has got it completely backwards. But it does lay the selfishness trip on you. It'll say, you're the most selfish. I've had that laid on me my whole life, saying you're a totally selfish person because you don't want, you know, to go through death and trauma and all this stuff, and you're resisting it. And you're supposed to be totally selfish. Not true. Opposite. By sharing the truth of what really works for our salvation, that is not being selfish. That's being helpful. That's playing the only essential part that can't be played for everyone to play the same part, is sharing the truth. There's one plan of salvation that works, that gets shared. Everyone will share it. It's not any special role. It's the role that everybody will participate in at some point. They will recognize, this is what really works, and they will share that with everyone. They're sharing it with reality. All those who re-engage entirely with reality and drop belief, choose a new idea. Everyone who shares, who has done that, when those in this dream of belief are decide to share truth with everyone, they'll be shared with those who've already gone on and dropped beyond belief. They will be aware of that sharing also. They'll be aware of it. Reality is aware of that. So everybody will end up sharing truth with everyone else. And it will be accepted by all aspects of the sonship, all aspects of spirit. So nobody plays a special role at all. No one. All play an equal role. The same role. Just expanded more, you know, everyone sharing with everyone else. Everyone sharing with everyone else. Automatic. So the guilt trip of selfishness keeps binding us to trauma, to death. Somebody has to step out of it, you know. Somebody has to say, yeah, you know, I reject this guilt trip. It's nonsense. It's very important, very important. So I aim for that. I aim for that. I don't know how it will play out. I really don't. Because we're so habituated to just going along with trauma and death, you know. It's the habituation is like, we're like zombies, you know, really. We just go along like a zombie, just like we're under some control. Some external power is controlling us and making us go along with this. It's very important that we don't get caught up in some situation that represents a high place in the afterlife, and that we're attracting those to that high place in the afterlife. You know, that's a very tricky thing, because belief will do that too. Belief will present itself as a loving, wonderful, loving presence that you know, is guaranteeing us a high place in the afterlife. And we can bond with that, with some goddess-like figure or something that we bond with, and thinking, okay, we're going to die, we're going to be traumatized, but we're going to go with this wonderful, beautiful, loving presence into a high place of the afterlife, and it'll be wonderful. You know, that's also part of belief. It's also a trick of belief. And there, that dynamic is at play in the world, absolutely. At play in the world is all sorts of marketing agents from different aspects of the afterlife, marketing that aspect of the afterlife as salvation. If you just go through the trauma, you will be taken to this particular place of the afterlife and be able to dwell there forever in perfect peace and love and harmony, etc. And that's nonsense, because at some point, wherever you are in the afterlife, belief will whisper in your ear and lay the guilt trip on you. And if you haven't seen through the guilt trip, you will return. You will find yourself exiting whatever beautiful little paradise you have in the afterlife, back into vulnerability, identifying with severe, brutal conditions. And you'll tear your hair out and say, oh my gosh, I hate this. This is terrible. But I gotta do it, otherwise I'll be responsible for everybody else failing. And you're back, you know. That's what happens. So the real teachers don't promise you any place in the afterlife. Okay? For instance, one of my teachers, a true teacher, Anandamayi, said, everybody without exception will eventually have to dwell in the land, the death-free realm. The death-free realm. Where no, dwell in that realm, where there's no possibility of any return ticket. Everyone will have to do that. That is what, you know, she didn't say, come dwell with me in some beautiful abode, you know, or anything. No, death-free realm. Everyone. No exception. She pointed out, all of the subtle realms, there's return tickets. They're not permanent. You have to free yourself from the entirety of belief. Even the highest subtle realms of belief are completely subject to guilt, the ultimate guilt trip laid on you. And that is not freedom. It is not freedom at all. It's still entirely within delusion. And you must free yourself from all of that, from belief, and from guilt. And then you dwell in the death-free realm, where there's no possibility of any threat whatsoever. In other words, you choose a new idea, you dwell in unconditional love, where there's no threat to anything, there's no death at all. So those are the true teachers. The true teachers are not promising you, giving you the notion that you're going to be with them in some subtle paradise, as it were. No, they're pointing out you need to choose a new idea, and you need to find yourself in re-engage with that which can never be threatened. Different kind of teaching. Different kind of promise. And you can tell the difference between the two. You can tell. You can tell. It's just rarely do we get the chance to contrast the two. When you get an opportunity, it's super important. Anandamayi for me gave the opportunity to contrast. I said, I knew this is genuine teacher of truth. And I contrasted her with a lot of other teachers, and I saw, there's a very, very big difference. Very big difference. Because she was honest. She said, honestly, I'm telling you that I find myself, I was invited by all the gods and goddesses, the subtle gods and goddesses, to be with them. And then I found myself there with all of them. And then they bowed down to me and they put me higher than all of them. And I saw, you know, that what I am truly is beyond all the gods and all the goddesses and all the subtle realms, etc. What I am, meaning reality, is. The I am presence of isness, the true, that which is higher beyond all the subtle realms and all the gods and goddesses that are so-called deities of those realms. Those who are temporarily identified with those realms, dwelling there, believing that this is their permanent abode, which it is not. She said, no, I'm above all, I'm beyond all of that. Meaning reality, is beyond all of that. And so she pointed that out, that it's a different story. These subtle gods and goddesses, you know, to try and validate themselves as being beyond guilt, will invite you to their beautiful abode in the afterlife and say, hey, this is permanent. Yes, permanent. Trying to believe that their situation there is permanent. Trying to establish permanency within belief. And you will find out it's not permanent. It's not even permanent for these gods and goddesses. Because it will be whispered in their ear at some point, hey, you know, it's time for you to save all of creation, or all of, you know, belief system. Everyone needs you now. It's your time. And they will find themselves identified with vulnerability again. That's a fact. And they might say, hey, you know, in the afterlife, I was this and this deity. And now I am here again on this planet, going through all this terrible afflictions here for you, to save you. And we'll worship them, say, oh, you know, we're worshiping you, it's wonderful. And you did this for us. You came down to suffer for us. No, they came down because belief whispered in their ear that it was now time for them, that if they didn't do their part right now, the whole plan would collapse. And they couldn't resist this guilt. That is why they came down. You're not supposed to worship them. Because they don't have the answer. They don't realize what's going on. So don't worship these deities, these subtle deities. You're worshiping your own death when your own trauma when you're worshiping these deities, because they don't have any capability to withstand that guilt. They will be sent down. It's not just that they're given a certain amount of time to be deluded enough, you know, let their guard down, and then guilt comes to them and taps them on the shoulder and says, hey, if you don't do your part, everyone else will fail and they'll be eternally damned. And then they go, oh my gosh, I gotta leave my beautiful loka, my beautiful place in the afterlife, in the subtle realms, and go back down to these lower realms, horrible, brutal, brutish places, right? And be torn limb from limb down there. But if I don't do it, everybody else is going to fail, and it'll be on me, it'll be my fault. They leave their beautiful loka, their subtle realm, where they're on these beautiful thrones and gossamer gowns and every, you know, fountains, and, you know, they have to leave it. Think, you know, fooled again. All the subtle deities get fooled again. It's just that, you know, they seem to be safe from that, but they're not safe from the ultimate guilt trip, because belief is just waiting for the right moment when they, you know, they can tap them on the shoulder when they feel most vulnerable. And when they're most vulnerable to guilt, that's when they're tapped on the shoulder and saying, it's your time. It's your time. That's why a real teacher like Ananda Mayama, she just say, yeah, you know, all these subtle deities are there in subtle realms, afterlife, etc. Fine. But true reality is beyond all that. And you have to free yourself from all of that. That's still part of this whole belief system. Still part of suffering. And of course she realized that everybody was praying to all these deities. What do people pray for in this world? Let's be honest, directly straightforward here. They're praying to these deities so that these deities will invite them to their beautiful little kingdom in the subtle realms. The afterlife realms. That's what they're praying for. You know, you see them during their life, you know, they can pray. And they're praying, you know, I pray to all the saints and all the sages and the gurus and the deities and all these, you know, they want to get into a very beautiful place after they get after they go through this horrible trauma and die various ways. That's what they're hoping for. They're not trying to get free of delusion. They're trying to just get a nice mansion on the hill in the afterlife. And it's like, you know, it's like a gated community, okay? Let's say the afterlife is like all these gated communities, okay? And all these country clubs, and you want to get into that country club. I mean, let's face it, in this planet, there's some very beautiful country clubs. I mean, super nice. You know, just, oh, so peaceful and beautiful. Everything looks like a park. It's so lush and green, and everything's being constantly taken care of and manicured, and wow, you know. The afterlife is like that, and in order to get into those country clubs, you have to, you know, have wealth, you have to have character witnesses, you have to be, you know, invited by other members. So, you know, there's this process you go through, and you get voted on eventually. So during here in this world, we pray, we say we want to get into some super nice country club in the sky and the afterlife. And so we want to, like, do good work. We want to get a resume we can present, say, look at all this good stuff I did. Look at all the spiritual wealth I've accrued by prayers. Now, what kind of prayers do those deities, you know, the deities are simply like the voting members on the board of the country club, and one might have a veto power over any new applicant. So we want to supplicate the deity, the veto power of this afterlife country club. We want to supplicate them and say, I'm willing to do whatever you want. I'll be the perfect citizen in your little kingdom, little country club kingdom. And I'll be so loving, I'll be kind, nice, just let me in. We're praying for that. That's what we do. We want to make sure we don't get vetoed, you know, that the gate will open. We get to the gate and say, yes, am I on the membership roll there? Did I get into this nice little country club? And if we say, yes, you made it, ah. Now these deities, what do they get out of it? They're hoping that by us giving our prayers to them and supplicating and bowing to them and say, oh, you're wonderful, that they will get to remain there. You see, because they feel the vulnerability, they might get moved out of there. They want to remain there. And if they have all these people in their little country club saying, we cannot live without the presiding deity of this place. So that the presiding deity must stay here for our sakes. Otherwise, we will feel so sad. That's all hoped. The presiding deity hopes that they can remain there and won't, guilt will not tap them on the shoulder and send them back down here. Because they could say, no, I'm too busy taking care of all the people here that need me here. If you send me back down there, I won't be able to take care of my people. So it's a codependency thing that we're trying to avoid getting sent back down by worshiping the presiding deity of the area. But they do get sent back down, and someone else takes over, and guilt comes and say, well, don't worry, we got someone else to take your place, and you have to be sent back down. So everybody in the belief is frantic to not get sent down into trauma, you know, to try to avoid it in some way. But nobody avoids it. Nobody avoids it. Yeah, we're all playing the game, you know, who do I need to worship to get into the country club, and who's the presiding deity? And the presiding deity is saying, who can I get to worship me so I don't get sent down? See, there's that dynamic between the presiding deities and the worshippers of those deities. Who can I get? And the presiding deity is saying, where can I find the devotees that will keep me from being sent back down? And the devotees are saying, what kind of presiding deity can I find that will step in and prevent me from being sent down? For instance, when we get tapped on the shoulder when we're in a country club in the afterlife, and belief tells us, your time, you got to go back down. We'll say, no, I don't want to get sent down. And we go to the presiding deity of that country club in the afterlife and saying, please intercede on my behalf. Please intercede on my behalf. I'm being told I have to go back down and suffer death again, and I don't want to go. So can you not intercede on my behalf with quote-unquote God? And the presiding deity will say, yeah, 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 don't worry. I'll work something out. We'll work something out. So we try to invest the presiding deity of these country clubs in the afterlife with the power to intercede with quote-unquote God, which is just belief, to prevent us from being sent down. And what happens is they buy us time. These presiding deities will buy us time. They'll go to belief and saying, look, let's juggle this and karma, blah, blah, blah. And we'll cut a deal and say, yeah, you get to stay here a little longer. Don't worry. You say, oh, thank you so much. God bless you. You're so wonderful. You interceded on my behalf. And maybe you get, you know, another 100 years there or something, whatever. But then finally you go to, again, you get told you got to go down. You go to the presiding deity. The presiding deity goes to the belief and says, hey, you know, this one I really worships me a lot, and I need to keep this one here because very important. And belief will say, well, we understand all that, but this one's role is so essential to save the whole plan that we can't delay in sending him down any longer, you know. And well, don't worry, we'll bring some more devotees to you, etc. And the deity says, oh, okay, goes back to you and says, you know what, I cut a plan with God, and God says, if you go back one more time, that'll be it for you, and you will be freed. You never have to go back again. And you say, really? And deity says, yeah. Deity, of course, presiding deity is lying to you, of course, totally. They don't realize it. They may even believe it, because they themselves want to believe that any return ticket will be their last one. So there's this collective delusion going on in existence, in the afterlife. I mean, the afterlife is where it all happens about getting sent back here. So that's why it's really a more important focus. The afterlife is a more important focus, because that's where all this whole stuff happens of desperately clinging to presiding deities desperately collecting devotees to cling to them, all these deals being worked out with so-called God, which is just belief there, and deals being struck, you know, and the whole thing, and eventually return ticket happens. It's all happening in the afterlife, which is why some gurus say, you know what, teaching in the afterlife is actually better, because that's where it's all happening and you can really focus on that. Possible. But also, while you're here in this world, it is very possible to see the entire scope of the delusion, because you can say, hey, I don't want to go back to some presiding deity, you see? I don't want to die. I don't want to be traumatized. I don't want to go back to some presiding deity, because I know I'll get a return ticket, and the whole thing is a scam, because the so-called God that they're cutting deals with is really belief. And ultimately, it all boils down to me being told that if I do my part, essential part, one more time, I won't ever have to come back. And I know that's a lie, because this plan can never work. So I'll always get sent back, and I'll always be told eventually that if I don't carry out my part, the entire plan will collapse for everyone. I know that will take place. And these presiding deities, they can't protect me from that guilt, because they're under the same guilt. They can't protect themselves from that guilt. So I don't want to go to some country club in the sky and the afterlife, where there's some presiding deity and worship the dead and go through that whole stuff. Forget it. Forget it. I want the freedom of reality. I want to function as the prime creator created me to function. I don't want to be bowing down and worshiping some presiding deity or something. Reality is not asking us to bow down and worship it. It's asking us to simply let it, accept it as it is. The total inclusiveness. And inherently, our experiencing is completely rich and delightful beyond any belief. And there's no deity asking us to bow down and worship the deity. The deity says, experience. Enjoy your experiencing. Enjoy your expansion. Enjoy the expansion. It's all yours. You're perfectly free. That is the true prime creator. So we need to get it straight, this whole afterlife thing. We need to get into it here. Okay? It's not too soon to get into it. Believe me on this. We need to vet the entire thing. So I've upped the momentum now of this sharing. Shifted gears, okay, where we're seeing the totality of the situation, even bringing in all the presiding deities of the afterlife and all these country clubs in the afterlife, these beautiful hangouts, rest and recreation places. And how, fact is, they're completely deluded also. and they're desperately trying to prevent themselves from being returning to trauma by literally sending you down in on their behalf. You know, belief taps them on the shoulder and says, you need to do your part. And the society says, well, wait a minute. I'll tell you what, I'll send 10 of my devotees down there in my place if you'll just let me stay here. And belief says, yeah, okay, okay. So they're cutting these deals with belief, sending you down to suffer trauma on their behalf, as if, you know, you're like saving them, you know, because they have some super important role to play in the afterlife. Nonsense. They're selling you out just to get another 100 years in the afterlife. You know, how could you see, if you see that, how could you possibly go along with that? They're cutting deals behind your back. And of course, and that just delay, and they keep delaying. And of course, at some point, they will find themselves having to go back too. And, you know, and they're none the wiser. You know, they're more deluded, extremely deluded. You might say these presiding deities are extremely deluded. They're just very clever deal makers who keep spinning this lie about sending, you know, sending their devotees down to suffer for them, so that they don't have to go down, you know. That's not salvation. That's not teaching the truth. Presiding deity should say, hey, you can all choose a new idea right now and you never have to return. And none of the devotees have to return. And I don't have to return. I can choose a new idea. And we'll all be equally free. And we'll all have the equal freedom, equal inclusiveness in reality. There's no levels in reality. There's no hierarchy in reality whatsoever. Hierarchy is only in the afterlife and all these subtle realms of all these deal makers who are, you know, each one's trying to pressure others to do the trauma for them, you know, claiming that they have some, you know, more exalted role within this plan. But this plan is completely futile, and eventually, you know, their so-called exalted role will end up, you know, they'll end up crawling in the gutter here in this world, you know, too, suffering, you know, the trauma of the body here, believing that they have to do this or the whole plan will collapse eventually, you know. So really, in the afterlife, you need to have this universal teaching, and you cannot have any deities of any of these subtle realms tell you what is true, you know. You cannot. You're beyond, reality's beyond all the subtle deities. It's beyond the afterlife. Entirely. All of that is just right, is belief. It's all the plan of belief. Belief's plan of salvation entirely. And it's actually totally deceptive. Totally deceptive. You know, you get attached to one of these subtle deities, they're going to tell you that you need to sacrifice yourself for their sake, because they're playing some super essential role, you know, and they can't go back down to trauma. You have to do it for them, and that the credit will accrue to them, and then that they will, yeah, total liars and deceivers. Totally. And of course they say, you don't want me to have to go down and be traumatized? No, of course, but I don't want anybody to go down and have to be traumatized. I don't place these subtle deities on any higher level than anyone else, none. It's all exactly the same, exactly equal. Everyone can choose a new idea right now. I don't want anybody to go identify with vulnerability. I don't want the subtle deities to do it. I don't want the devotees of any of these subtle deities to do it either. No one has to do it. No one has to carry out the plan of salvation of belief. There is no salvation within the plan of belief. It's futile. That plan is futile. 100% futile from the very beginning. In fact, no step towards progress has ever been taken. None. None. So that is the teaching. You know, in the subtle realms, that is the teaching. And of course, nobody will accept that teaching there either, because they say, oh, you're disrespecting my deity. My deity tells me it's cutting a deal with me. It's going to, I need to just go one more trauma and then I'm going to be free. And that deity's assured me of that, that I just have to give that one more trip to trauma to the deity, and the deity then will cut a deal with God, and I'll be saved. Same lie. It's the same lie. It's the same lie. All throughout belief is the same lie. So this hierarchy system has been, you know, set up, and these deities are hanging out in these subtle realms, you know, exploiting, you know, everyone else. But the ones who get exploited, they're the ones who actually wise up to it, you know. They say, hey, wait a minute. I thought we had a deal and you didn't keep your side of the bargain. You say, I've got to go again. I said, no. I said, I'm not going again under any circumstances. So where is my, you know, where is my payoff? They can't give it. I say, you can't give it to me. I don't feel certain, you know, that I don't have to return ticket. So you're not keeping your bargain. And at that point, you start saying, wait a minute, you know, these you know, are faithless. They don't keep their promises. Sure, they promised us the moon. They'll promise us salvation. But it's a false promise. What they're really doing is telling us to sacrifice ourselves for their sake so they don't have to go down in trauma because they're still, you know, they don't want that guilt trip laid on them. And they make a bargain with guilt, saying, hey, I'll give you 10 traumas if you just spare me, you know. And belief says, okay. Very wicked thing. You know, isn't it? The whole system of belief is held together with all these, this so-called bargaining, you know, with reality. Reality often offers no bargains. Reality simply offers the truth, salvation, choose a new idea. There's no need for any bargain. That's not a bargain. That's just the way to be saved. It's perfect. That which offers the easy and perfect means of salvation, why does it need to deal in bargains? It has no deal in bargains. It's only belief that deals in bargains. And the belief is the great bargainer, and it's a great deceiver and liar. When it is said, it's like Jesus is the only way, etc. Well, what they're trying to get at is that this choosing a new idea is the only way. And forget about all these subtle deities. They can't give you salvation. They cannot. The idea of stop worshiping all these subtle deities, that's a good one. That's very helpful to hear that. Now, where people fall on their face is believing that Jesus is the king of subtle deities, is the highest of subtle deities. That is not true. Jesus was simply an aspect of spirit that recognized the one way to salvation, which is to choose a new idea, and recognize that that's the same for everyone, including all the subtle deities. He was not placing himself, you know, higher or lower than any other aspect of spirit, realizing there is no hierarchy in reality. And he's not saying that he's the only one that can choose this. Everybody can choose. Everyone has to choose it. What he was saying is, don't keep worshiping all these deities because they can't give you salvation. They'll cut bargains for you that might delay you being re-traumatized again, but you in no way are free of belief, this whole cycle. It's just you keep cycling, maybe slower, and then later on maybe faster. You're still completely deluded. You don't see through it at all. So, but he was not putting himself up as something special, some special deity. No way. That'd be the opposite of truth. Reality, again, is perfect inclusiveness, perfect freedom for all of reality. How can there be any specialness? There's no specialness in reality. None. There's no higher or lower in reality. All right, very great. That's it for now. I gotta get this mouse. Let me see. I hear someone coming. Let me see if I can get this mouse to work. Okay. Quickly, is it working? Did it unfreeze? Can I unfreeze it? No, I can't get it to work. Ha! The light's on. I need to unfreeze. Aha! Okay, I'm moving it now. Kinda. Where is it? Where'd it go? Where'd that mouse go? searching for the mouse. I have to find this mouse. It stopped again. Doggone it. Okay. Come on, mouse. Unfreeze yourself. No, it will not do it. I must go get a battery. Okay. So if you want, you can meditate on what's being said. I'm going to leave the scene here. I'm going to leave the camera on because I have to go find a battery somewhere. So enjoy the emptiness set. All right, let's see if we can get this mouse to work. As you're considering all this, what's been said about the deities and how they're cutting deals and they don't really can't give you salvation and it's all a waste of time and you don't want to keep wasting your time and be traumatized again, etc., etc. There's a green light. Let's see if the mouse is going to work. Is working. Very great. Of course, now I don't have to stop it. Don't have to stop the video. Now that the mouse is working. Okay, yeah. Maybe that's a foreshadowing of something. I'm thinking maybe I might retreat for a little while at some point. I don't know. And then come back. I need to adjust this. Let me see if I can adjust this too. Yeah, there you go. Everything is now adjustable. Look at that. All right. It's possible, you know, that's something that's been coming up to my attention is maybe to retreat for a while, and then come back, you know, and try to help out in some way is a possibility. Retreat to kind of really crystallize, you know, the clarity, so the clarity can handle being in the world and dealing with people here in the world, which is a very difficult thing to do, actually. Because of this, again, everybody is trying to negotiate a bargain, a deal with belief. And that's what's taking place. And to tell people, there is no deal with belief. Forget about trying to cut a deal with belief. It people get super angry. They say, wow, you're trying to prevent me from, you know, getting into a real nice place in the afterlife. You're trying to prevent me from returning here. Prevent me from doing what I have to do. People can get very defensive about that. I found it super difficult to teach the truth here. Super difficult. It's not so difficult doing these videos because I'm not dealing one-on-one with anybody directly. Because people certainly, you know, might panic in hearing this, saying, wait a minute, you know, it's like the rug is being pulled out from underneath them. You know, everything is like, whoa. You know, the afterlife is not it, and the deities are not it, and making these bargains is not it, and none of this stuff is it that I've been banking on for so long. And you say, yeah, none of that's it. And they'll feel like, you know, could feel panicky, like, so it's not such an easy thing to help, introduce the true plan of salvation, of choosing a new idea, when you have those who have set up their own traumas. The whole trauma thing has been set up for them. They think they have to, you know, succeed with this trauma, and they're praying to deities to get into a nice country club in the afterlife, and they think they'll be able to stay there and figure a way to stay there. When they're focused on all of that, and you just say, hey, don't focus on any of that. That will never work for you. You know, that's a tough sell. It's a very tough sell. But there are... It's what happens is, in this belief system, what happens is, if you try to teach the truth, people come to you and they try to set you up as a presiding deity, and they're saying, oh, I'll tell you what, we can tell that, you know, you really have some capability to really negotiate with God very, 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 very capably. You're a super negotiator, obviously. You're so happy, you're blissful. You must be some super negotiator, and you're able to negotiate a settlement with God. And we will agree to worship you. We'll be your devotees if you just let us dwell with you where, you know, where your subtle realm is going to be. 1 second here. They want to set you, they want you to give them some special place in the afterlife, and that you'll be the presiding deity, and they just think, well, you've got some in with God, you know, you really got some in with God, and that you can then protect them from being sent back down and be re-traumatized. And so they will worship you under those conditions, under that pretext. That's a totally false pretext, though. Totally false. And Anna Maima experienced that constantly. Everywhere she went, she says, people would say, oh, you're the presiding deity we've been praying for all these years. You finally come here for us. And you're going to remain here forever with us and bring us beautiful peace and happiness. And when she'd get ready to leave, they'd tell her, you can't leave. You cannot leave us. They'd insist, you cannot leave us. We've been worshiping you for centuries. How can you leave us, you know? And she says, you know, I'm not able to stay here, I'm sorry. And she'd leave, and they'd say, get all crying and devastated. They'd get devastated because they believed that she was the presiding deity, which was going to give them eternal peace and happiness in some subtle realm, which was not true. It's not true. She was not a presiding deity of anything. She was simply showing us what choosing a new idea is like. And then you can do this. It's unconditional love. She's showing us this is the effect you get when you choose to let everything be as it, let reality be as it is, and not try to change it. You get this unconditional love. That's what you get. And so, yet everyone automatically assumed she was the presiding deity. So wherever she went, it was assumed that she was the presiding deity that these people have been praying to for all this time. Invariably. That's why she had so many names. People say, oh, this is Kali Ma, this is this, that, you know. She is the presiding deity, you know, of that we have been praying to all this time. And then, but really, she'd say, no, I'm nothing, I'm nobody, I'm none of that. I'm not any presiding deity at all. There's only one God, and that God, that one God is all. It is. There is no other. So what happens, so when you try and teach in this world the truth, that you show the effects of choosing a new idea, which is unconditional love, people assume that you're the presiding deity that they have been worshiping, or they assume that you must be that one. And that now that they're, and that's presiding deity is making good on the bargain that they made with that presiding deity. Finally, they're here to take them to that, you know, perfect place. Subtle place within belief. And it's not true. It's not true. So you have to not get caught up in that. Very difficult. So how to not get caught up in that is the question. Maybe it's necessary to go to some kind of retreat where you really get entirely free of this thing, and so you're able then to move in the world and bear witness to the effect of unconditional, the effect of choosing a new idea without getting entrapped in this deity worshiping thing of believing that you can give some special place to those who want to worship you. See, that's not where it's at all. You have to gently say, you know, hey, I gotta go. This, you know, you have to recognize you're beyond all deities. Reality's beyond all deities of belief. Entirely beyond all that. Not just a progression. It isn't totally other than that. It has nothing to do with it. Nothing. Reality is immutable, constant, seamless, flawless, perfect, you know, all-inclusive, perfectly free, cannot be threatened in any way. Happiness is permanent there. So if I do happen to go on retreat, you know, in some way, it will be for that purpose to come back later, perhaps, and be able to be of help, where you get a taste of this unconditional love, this perfect peace, without getting entrapped into this deity-worshipping dynamic of belief, so that you use that and motivate you to see through the whole situation of the lie of belief, where you're able to reject guilt entirely, the guilt trip that belief lays upon you, that total belief, that guilt trip that you're, if you choose a new idea, you're letting everyone else down and you're going to cause the whole plan to collapse. Again, the plan never got off the ground in the first place, so how can it collapse? That which never arose at all, how can it collapse? There's been zero success, how can it collapse then? It's a total lie. All right, so who knows what's going to happen? November's almost here. And you know, I told you November is the time when the pot is going to be stirred. And you can see it coming, can't you? You can see it coming. All sorts of voter fraud stuff is arising, potentially arising. All sorts of chicanery. The situation where the election has likely become so muddled that, you know, people will never pull themselves out of it. And no satisfactory resolution is going to come about, really. And then people will just then be attracted to trauma, you know. The attraction to trauma is going to become severe, really severe. You'll have all these, you know, dancing dakinis here, dakinis in bikinis, you know, dancing towards trauma. And you'll say, hey, this is just my life, this is my destiny, and I'm going to get a great place in the afterlife because of this, etc. It'll become contagious. It'll be a raging inferno here. A raging inferno. And if I go on retreat, it's only to return at some point to help those who really want to be helped, to really give them the boost that they deserve, you know? Because it's going to be a raging inferno. You have to put on an asbestos suit, you know, to deal with it. Really. And, you know, these videos are helpful. I know they are. Maybe I can be even more helpful at some point, which is actually, you know, meeting and greeting some people at some point. I'm not able to do that right now, simply because the dynamic there, the potential dynamic to get suckered into this, you know, deity dynamic thing, you know, it's still potential. I certainly don't want to get suckered into that. I don't want to be anybody cutting a deal with me and saying, we'll worship you, we'll be devoted to you, if you can cut a deal with God, so to speak, to believe and give us a great place in the afterlife. I don't want to be part of that. That would just entrap me in delusion. I'm no, there's no interest in that. So how to be in the world but not of it, and how to be invulnerable to that dynamic, and how to truly help others is, you know, all important during this time, because the raging inferno is coming for sure. The Dakinis are like subtle, beautiful goddess-like entities who work the attraction to trauma angle. And they're all here in the world right now. So many Dakinis in the world right now. So many. They got sent down by their presiding deities of the place in the afterlife where they were dwelling, who told them that they're cutting a deal for them and they only have to come back one more time. And if they work to attract others to their destiny of trauma, that they will never have to return here. In other words, they got lied to again. They're here in this world now, and their Dakinis can be super sexy. You know, they can all put on super sexy bikinis, and they can all work very cleverly to attract the world to trauma. And there's just a massive amount of those types in this world right now, coming from the subtle realms, being lied to, saying if they do this job, one more job, that they'll be freed, never have to come back. You know, totally lied to. And so they're all ready, you know, to take off their clothes and jump around in bikinis here and dance, great, you know, beautiful. You know, in the 60s, we were love-bombed in the 60s by all these Dakinis. It was incredible. I mean, you look back some of the old videos and, you know, it was unbelievable how these attractive these Dakinis were at that time. How they're doing their go-go dancing, you know, in their white boots. And you know, it was just super attractive time. Attracting us to trauma, attracting us into trauma is what it was. And why were they doing that? Because they were promised that if they did that, they would never have to return here, which was a complete lie. It's always a lie. And now there's just, you know, way more Dakinis in the world. And we're going to get this super sexy dance from them. And that is going to attract us to trauma, thinking that it's all, you know, all one, all part of a package deal. And so that's become a raging inferno. It's the calm before the storm right now. And back at those times, there, you know, there was some modesty at that time. But the Dakinis have become now so immodest, you know, super aggressive, super immodest, you know. No modesty, no shame whatsoever. They're willing to do any dance that's required to attract us to trauma. Any dance at all. And so the world, you know, has the potential to become extremely shameless, modest, as well as super traumatic and violent. That's what's on tap. And so the ability to have no attraction to any of that, you know, and say, hey, choose a new idea, unconditional love, that is the true attraction. You have to have a real strong asbestos suit. You know, you really have to be not vulnerable to any of that, to any of the Dakinis, you know, have been, you know, the millions, hundreds of millions, maybe billions on the planet who have their song and dance already. They're rehearsing. They've been rehearsing their song and dance, the siren song, to attract a trauma. Obviously, the sirens is that Dakinis who do this, so this beautiful, enchanting, sexy dance and you know, drawing the ship towards them, and the sailors don't even see that they're being drawn toward these rocks, and the sailors only fixated on the Dakinis, and the ship gets wrecked on the rocks, and all the sailors drown, traumatized, right? That's exactly what happens in this world. It's exactly what's taking place. We get so entranced by the song and dance of the Dakinis in bikinis that we don't realize we're going headlong over the cliff, getting wrecked on the rocks. And then, of course, we're supposed to be grateful for them because we carried out our role of being traumatized, and now we believe that we are never going to have to come back to trauma, too. You know, all a lie. All of it. Everyone that follows that path always gets a return ticket to trauma. Always. Everyone who follows the path of belief gets a return ticket to trauma. Belief will always send you back, will always lay that guilt trip on you, always. It's only by choosing a new idea where, and then belief doesn't arise at all for you, that you are invulnerable to that. You're experiencing unconditional love. There's no belief about it. There's no call to trauma at all in that. That's the only way. The only way. I think what a lot of people are hoping is they'll just get some super attractive bikini dance and the trauma will be short-lived, you know, and they won't even feel it, you know. It's like, oh, it's blissful. I'm so happy to jump into the jaws of death and get devoured by trauma, because I'm just grooving on this beautiful go-go dancing, you know, the bikinis, and it'll be no problem. That's what they're, you know, banking on that. It'll be merciful and quick, but trauma that's in store for the world is not merciful or quick. It's multi-layered, you know. It's on many levels of devastation. It's going to be very traumatic. And the dakinis are there to do their go-go dance, just to hold our attention as all the layers of belief, you know, the emotional, the physical, the mental, the cause, all these different aspects of belief are going to be traumatized. We're going to experience, you know, everything slipping through our fingers, everything we've built up gradually collapsing, slow motion train wreck, you know, gruesome, horrible aspects, and it's just going to be this enormous, enormous trauma of losing everything slowly, in the most horrible, inextricable, terrifying way. And so the dakinis and bikinis are here to keep holding our attention. They keep dancing ahead of this thing, you know. Hey, don't give up yet. Don't choose a new idea yet. Look how attractive it is here. And then we wait and we get traumatized worse. And then they say, look over here, we're dancing here now. We wait, we get traumatized even worse. It's like that. Progressive trauma has been set up. And always in the distance, at the end of the rainbow, there's these go-go dancers, you know, doing their go-go thing, and you say, wow, you know, maybe I need to keep chasing after that rainbow. And as you keep chasing after the rainbow, you're getting brutalized in every, you know, from every angle. That is what is going to happen. So you have to see something more attractive than these go-go dancers, as it were. Or the glamorous option too is glamorous beings, how can I become one of these presiding deities? That option's on the table too. How can I become both male and female? It seems to work out more with females being presiding deities, but also males. How can I become one of these presiding deities? So there are a lot of people here, they're working on that. They think they can get a rung up on the corporate hierarchy of belief in the afterlife, and they can be a presiding deity. They can, you know, so there's various things going on. They're cutting deals. You know, a lot of deal cutters are working. A lot of stuff going on. A lot of stuff. It's all moving and shaking. It's all business as usual, though. It's just going to become, you know, the marketplace is becoming more aware of, like, wow. You know, it gets really chaotic, seemingly chaotic. But there's method to the madness. There's all this deal making going on. And people might, if you're here witnessing the truth, people might think you're a super deal maker and they want to figure out how to make a better deal. But again, choosing a new idea is not a deal. It's not making a deal with belief. No deal with belief. It's choosing a new idea where belief doesn't even arise. So there's no belief there to make a deal with. So it's not deal making at all. The opposite of deal making. It's the sure thing. It's the inevitable, perfect, sure remedy. It's not a deal. A deal means there's something else that you got to satisfy. No. You don't have to. Once you choose a new idea, you don't have to satisfy belief at all. So, you know, I said that October 27th is always been my lucky day. Look at this. You know, nothing significant has happened as far as, you know, Satori, enlightenment, freedom, relief, you know. But what has happened so far is that I've been able to share with you the total picture of all the afterlife, the subtle thing, the deal making, the entire, the guilt trip, the ultimate guilt trip, all of that has come together in a nice package, you know, where I can share it. Whereas up to this point, I was not able to quite do that. So it is an extreme breakthrough on my part, actually, because I've witnessed to the sonship the ability here to show the entire picture, to explain the whole picture, to clarify the entire picture. I've done it. That is a huge breakthrough, actually. That sets up something else. You know, for me, it might set up some other situation where I'm, you know, confirmed in all of this in some way to be more helpful. But definitely, this is a high water mark of being able to get into the entire picture, including the totality of the afterlife, the totality of all the deities, subtle deities, the guilt system that belief uses, and the deal making, and the whole shebang, is in the dakinis and bikinis doing their dance here, attracting us to trauma, etc., etc. The whole picture is here. And, you know, came on the 27th of October. It's always been my lucky day. I always look forward to that day because I know that something really profound is going to happen on that day. And again, it has happened again on this day. It's just not in the way that I expected. I didn't expect to get into this, you know. I got up in the morning and I felt like I need to do something. Nothing happened during the night. And I said, wow, the day has to be very important. How am I going to make the day important? And I couldn't figure it out. And then suddenly the notion of, hey, talk about the afterlife. Make that the topic. Start there. So I said, okay, let's start a video talking about the afterlife. And it's just mushroomed, it's snowballed, it's expanded into complete exposition. Piece of cake. Is not difficult for me. You know, I'll be persona non grata in any of these deities, you know, country clubs, but the fact is actually not, because each one of those presiding deities thinks that if you're free of belief and you have unconditional love, they think somehow you cut a perfect deal with belief. And so they welcome you to their country club saying, oh, come in. Show me how that I can cut the same deal. So you don't really become persona non grata. You become welcome everywhere because everybody thinks you cut some special deal with belief, but it's not true. It's not true. And then you have to tell them, you know, hey, you know, there's a way to, you don't have to cut a deal with belief anymore. You can be free of that. And then the presiding deity might say, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I think I see, you know. You might ask, where does Jesus or Anandamayama or Buddha, Ramana go, you know, after they've witnessed us here? Well, oftentimes they go witness in the subtle realms to all these presiding deities. They go from place to place to place in these subtle realms, witnessing there, helping those there recognize the delusional deal-making game that they're enmeshed in with belief, and how belief is deceiving them, how they're being deceived by belief. They're showing them what's going on in the subtle realms. Very, very possible. Sri Yukteswar, who was a guru of Yogananda, said that was what he did. When once his body passed away here, he was witnessing in the subtle realms what's going on there, helping out there. So, yeah, absolutely. Can someone like Jesus or Anandamayama come back into this world witness here? Of course. Or they might not. They might continue witnessing in the subtle realms, helping those who, you know, once were those in the afterlife, to keep on working to get free of this delusion, to resist the ultimate guilt trip, which has to be dismissed, has to be helping them, so that, you know, they can do a lot of help, a lot of good there, a lot of help. And again, they're welcome there because everyone believes they cut the ultimate deal with belief. It's not true. There's no deal you can cut with belief. The belief has nothing to offer us that we really want, nothing. And we don't need to cut any deal with reality because we're already, from the very beginning, perfectly included in reality, perfectly. No deal necessary. Simply choose a new idea. That's it. So the danger, like for me, I'm looking at him saying, well, I certainly don't want to get hooked up with some subtle presiding deity who thinks I've cut some great deal and that I'm teaching them how to cut the same great deal. I don't want to get hooked up with that. That's a fear that I have, you know. It's some, you know, some super beautiful, subtle, deep presiding deity of some subtle realm of the afterlife could be in the world now, have come into the world, and they say, hey, you can, you know, help me out or something, and I make, you know, get hooked up with that. That's definitely a danger, absolutely. There are lots of those. There's always presiding deities in the subtle realms. There are always those who have to come back in this world. They're constantly coming back, but, you know, so there are, you know, there are some in this world who were presiding deities in the subtle realms, and they got the guilt trip pushed them down here, and they're here now. And, you know, of course, they think that they're really, really important, and they need devotees, and, you know, they keep on this whole thing going here. And they certainly look for those who know truth to boost their claims. Like, hey, I'm a subtle deity, presiding deity. How come I'm down here? You can you help me, you know, be more happy, you know, and cut a deal with God for me? I don't have to keep coming back here. And then they can hook you into that. And they will use their charm and their entitlement and all that stuff. Presiding deities have an attitude of entitlement and charm, spiritual charisma, and all this kind of stuff. And how to not be vulnerable to that is certainly a concern. Because they can be very beguiling, and it's more of like they have a super entitlement complex. Like they're close to God. They're not close to God. Everyone is equally close to God. Everyone is already perfectly included in reality. There's no hierarchy in reality. And yet those in belief system believe in this. There's this hierarchy of closeness to God. And so they, if they think they're a high presiding deity, they believe that they're really close to God, and they're entitled then to, for everyone else beneath them, to worship them and acknowledge their closeness to God in comparison to others. And so they have this entitlement complex. Believe me, I ran into that when I was young, and I just backed away and became anonymous, and so they couldn't find me. Again, when Sri Anandamayi Ma traveled around, everyone tried to imprison her, really. They really said, you have to stay in our village, you can't leave. They really tried to keep her from leaving. They could not, because she didn't recognize their authority to do so, their entitlement. She saw everyone, all as God, all equal, no levels whatsoever. So they couldn't keep her, but they tried. They tried to imprison her, tried to keep her. All sorts of people tried to work their entitlement complex. Mahatma Gandhi really tried to keep her within his orbit, you know, where he was the presiding deity, you know, of a lot of people, and he tried his very best to twist her arm, and actually he got her to come to his place where he was staying, his compound, and he insisted, he ordered her not to leave. He said, I directly am ordering you that you must stay. You cannot leave this compound. And she said, I'm very sorry to let you down and upset you this way, but I'm unable to respond to any orders whatsoever. I simply am moved by divine grace that I cannot resist this movement that is moving me to different places, and I'm not able to comply with your order. And he was very upset. Because nobody disobeyed his orders like that, you see. This is Mahatma Gandhi. You know, this is like, you know, some very high presiding deity, you know, here in this world, supposedly. And she, you know, just said, like, I'm not able to honor your order. I have to leave. And she left, and oh boy, that was it. Because what happened was, he was sending people to her to try and get her to come stay with him. Some of his top lieutenants went to see Anandamayi Ma, and when they went to see her, they said, oh my gosh, you know, this is freedom itself. And they didn't want to leave her, and they became her devotees. And they said, no, I don't want to leave her. She's the truth. And Mahatma Gandhi got very upset about this, felt very threatened by it. So he found a way to invite her to his compound. And then once he got her in his compound, that's when he insisted that she not leave his compound. Because, you know, he felt like his own, those who were his devotees were switching over to her. And he said, no, I don't want this. So the only way he could keep his devotees with him, he felt, was to have Anandamayi stay with him, with his compound. And that way his top lieutenants would not leave him. They'd stay with him. So that is what has really happened. That is an interesting sidebar in history that is very relevant, highly relevant. You know, a lot of people, really, when I grew up, the top person in the world from all these people who believe in belief, the number one person in the world was Mahatma Gandhi. And we were all taught that we were supposed to be like Mahatma Gandhi. That was what we were taught. He was the number one guy. You know, for those who talk about heroes, if you say, if you want to do the right thing in life, okay, this is what we're told, if you want to get right with God, the way to do is you have to be like Mahatma Gandhi. You have to be that way. Okay? And I always said, no. That's not it at all. He's just a subtle presiding deity who's come out of the subtle realms, who's come here to this world. But he's deluded. It's not it. And people looked at me when I told them that. They said, You're crazy. How could you say such a thing? He's such a peaceful, wonderful person, etc., etc. Well, that was the perception. But he was very much a control freak, you know. And he's a presiding deity. He had the attitude of entitlement and presiding deityness and stuff. And I said, no, that's not it. And then it comes out later of this whole thing with Anandamayi Ma, what happened there. You see, he wanted to make her the presiding deity of India. And the whole thing was set up with Nehru, whose wife was one of Anandamayi Ma's strong devotees. His wife introduced Nehru to Anandamayi Ma, and introduced all these people around Gandhi who were trying to set up an independent India from the Raj, the British Raj. And they said, India needs a presiding deity, so all the people can then worship that presiding deity, and that will enable India to become strong and independent of this other presiding deity, which was the British Raj, you see. So they had this whole thing worked out subtly, you know, using all the subtle deal makings of the subtle realms. And then they tabbed Anandamayi Ma to be that presiding deity. And they said, your face is going to be on all the currency, the stamps, the currency, and you will be the founding mother of Bharat, of New India, independent, free India. And India will be the presiding deity of the entire planet. It will be the spiritual beacon to the entire planet. In other words, it will be the highest loka realm on the planet. That was their goal. And they said, in order to reach this goal, you, Anandamayi Ma, have to agree to be the presiding deity of this plan of India. And she refused. She said, that's not my purpose here. And so what happened was, Nehru went to Gandhi, okay? And Nehru had other movers and shakers behind him, gurus and very subtle presiding deities who had this plan, you know, for this earth, planet Earth, of making India the leader of this planet Earth. And Nehru, through his wife, who was a devotee of Anandamayi Ma, got Anandamayi Ma to agree to go visit Gandhi, because Nehru went to Gandhi and said, Gandhi, we need this great guru to be the presiding deity. The gurus have told me this is how it has to be done of India, and she won't agree to it. I can't get her to agree to it. So you have to get her to agree with it, because you are higher than me. The people, all the people will follow you, Gandhi, and you have all these devotees, and you can turn those over to her. You can make a deal with her. So Gandhi then invited her to his compound, and he said, look, this is the deal that I'm going to make with you. I'm going to say to all the people that are following me, because I'm the father of independent India, right? That I'm going to tell them that you're greater than me. and I'm going to tell everyone to bow down to you and worship you if you agree to be the presiding deity of India. That is the deal that was offered her. And she said, Papaji, I am sorry, but I'm just a little ignorant child. I cannot fulfill any such request. I'm a crazy little child. That's what she always say. I'm just some crazy little idiot who has no capability to understand or do any of this kind of stuff. And I'm just, you know, I just wander where my kayal, my guidance takes me. And I'm, you know, I'm very sorry, Papaji. I cannot do any of these things. Of course, she knew exactly what they were trying to do. But she played the village idiot kind of thing, which she often did, where she's just an ignorant little child who hasn't, you know, who's too, you know, very clamped in her mind to understand anything. And you know, I'm sorry, I don't know what you're talking about. I can't do it. That's what she did. And Gandhi said, oh, come on, you got to do it, because we need you. The country needs you. All these people need you. And he says, look, first we'll establish this super state of India, and we'll put you as the founding mother, and you'll be on all the currency, and everyone will bow down and worship you. And then by everyone turning to you and bow down and worshiping you, that'll lift the whole of India up spiritually. We'll be spiritually enriched, and we'll become the super spiritual super state of the world. And we'll be the true controllers and leaders and guiders of the whole planet. And will control the whole planet, will bring peace to the entire planet. They believed that. They really believed it. A lot of the subtle presiding deities had worked out this plan with belief to use India in that way. And they were caught up in that. And she flat out turned them down. No, not the slightest temptation to accept that offer. Imagine that. You know, where you know, a billion people were going to bow down and worship her and accept her as like the presiding deity of this planet, even, was set up, you know. And she just laughed and said, you know, she could tell them straight out. She said, look, I have been meeting and greeting with presiding deities of the entire universe, and they all bow down and worship me and say, please be the presiding deity of this universe. She says, I know, I'm just a crazy little child. I can't possibly do any such thing. Because she knew that reality is completely beyond all of this. And she's witnessing to reality, not to belief. So that is, you know, the true teacher gets tempted in that way. She really was tempted in the most incredible way. This is absolutely true story. As witnessed and written down at the time. And she also told to some who asked her the story, what happened. And it's super important to understand this. Points out the dynamic of the world. This world is trying to set up presiding deities over this planet, and you will get offered those positions if you have this, you know, wonderful spiritual presence about you. The subtle movers and shakers and the bargain makers will say, aha, we can use this one to, you know, get what we want, you know, to raise us up in the subtle realms so we don't have to return, you know. We can cut a deal with God here. We're doing God's work here by doing all this stuff. And they'll try to get you to be a presiding deity instead of a freedom in reality. They'll say, hey, here's this position, a presiding deity, you're going to help save everybody. Not true. You will actually bind them to delusion even worse. If Ananda Maima said, yes, I'll do it, she would have bound everyone here to delusion severely, incredibly severely, because we would be worshiping a fraud at that point. See, her spiritual charisma we use to perpetrate a fraud, that there's some deal you can cut with belief. So she said, no way. No, I can't do it. No way. So her spiritual charisma then was used to alert us to this trick, to belief, and help us see past the fraud of belief, and alert us that there is this perfect freedom and love available to us by simply choosing a new idea. So she did the right thing. Otherwise, guaranteed, I would not be here right now. If she had accepted that from Gandhi, no way. Then I would have got caught up, the world got caught up into this deal making, worshiping Gandhi, thinking he's like some supreme, super high, just below Anandamayi, you know, and that setting up this presiding deity, super state of India, etc. All of that would have taken place, and we would have been enmeshed in the darkest of deceptions. Because the prettiest of faces, the greatest of spiritual charisma would have been used in that false way of believing that we need to make a deal with belief, you know, instead of choosing a new idea, and would have really bound us badly. But there was no possibility she would accept, no possibility. Wasn't any possibility whatsoever, zero possibility of that happening. And yet they made the effort, and that's on the record, and that shows you how belief system, how it works. Because all those people who would be bowing down to her wouldn't be bowing down to truth. They'd be bowing down to her as a presiding deity within belief, thinking that they can cut a special deal with belief, with God, you know? That would have just strengthened delusion. Strengthened it. They say, why do we need to choose a new idea? We have this perfect presiding deity within belief, which will prevent us from ever returning to trauma or whatever, you know. Not possible, because they would still be believing in belief. And believing in belief, this plan is futile. And the only way you can keep pursuing this plan is more trauma. And the only way they can get you to do that is lay the guilt trip on you. And you have no resistance to it. See? Would have made things immeasurably worse. Maybe the real story of Jesus is that he came here in the world and refused to set himself up as the savior of the world, as the presiding deity of this planet. And there were those in the subtle realms that were trying to use him that way, and he refused. And they then said, we're going to put you to death if you don't do what we tell you to do. And he still refused, and so they put him to death. And he was showing us that under no circumstances do you ever make such a deal. Don't ever get tempted into making that, trying to be, accept the role of the presiding deity, even under the threat of losing their body, having your body put to death. Do not do it. So in that way of looking at it, it's very, very helpful to show us that the bargain is worse than death. The bargain is delay. The bargain, it will enmesh you in immense trauma and death over and over and over and over if you keep going that route of trying to believe that there's some bargain you can cut, some deal you can cut with belief. And there is not. There is not. So Jesus said, hey, no deal, I'm not accepting that. They said, where are you going? You can't leave us. You know, his disciples, the apostles said, you can't leave us. You know, as he's leaving the planet, say, where are you going? You can't leave us. They really told him, you can't leave us. How dare you leave us? You're supposed to be the presiding deity here. And he says, no. This is the kingdom of darkness. This isn't my kingdom. I'm going to the kingdom of heaven, my Father's kingdom. This isn't my kingdom. Right? Very great teaching there. He refused the offer of being a presiding deity. He refused it. And of course, everybody claims, you know, that no, he accepted it. He just is going to return. He just is waiting for us to get ready for him to return, and then he's going to be the presiding deity of this kingdom. Nonsense. Never said that. He was returning to be the presiding deity of this planet. No way. If he returns, it will return to take those, harvest those who are ready to go beyond belief and choose a new idea. That's the only reason to witness to the truth of don't settle for being a presiding deity. That is still entirely vulnerable to guilt, and you'll continue to be traumatized. Don't do that. Choose a new idea. That's what A Course in Miracles says. Choose a new idea. Exchange ideas. You have to choose a new causal agent. That's salvation. So, he's not coming back to be a presiding deity, but that's what most those who follow Jesus say they do are expecting. Because they say, well, Why do you leave? Why do you leave? Well, he must have just be temporary, and he's going to come back and accept our offer. You know, he couldn't really reject our offer to be presiding deity. That's not possible. I can't believe in that, right? Belief can't believe in that. Belief cannot believe that someone will entirely reject belief. And no, belief is incapable of believing that. So belief has to believe that Jesus is just a temporary absence and going to return and accept the offer of being presiding deity over this planet. Belief, that's what belief believes. But it's not true, not true at all. And many are believing that he's going to, and then he's going to slay all those who won't worship him as a presiding deity of this planet. That's their belief that's going to happen, that Jesus is going to come back with a whole big army, and that's going to absolutely wipe out all of the presiding deities and destroy him, kill him, annihilate him, throw him down into a lake of fire, and it's going to be the only presiding deity over this planet. And then there will be peace and love and harmony forevermore on this planet. You know, that is the... that is the fantasy of belief. Nothing but a fantasy of belief. Presiding deity. The same thing, it's just like the afterlife. It's like bringing the afterlife to this planet, like bringing heaven to earth. That's what they're saying. When people talk about heaven, they mean the afterlife. And the notion is we're going to bring the afterlife to earth, and earth will be like the afterlife. What is the afterlife like? Presiding deities over various locales, right? Telling you that, you know, if you worship them, you won't have to return to trauma, which is a lie. And they're perpetrating this lie because they don't want to return to trauma, thinking that if they can deliver trauma to belief, that they don't have to go. So they will end up sacrificing you to protect their own hide. So they, you know, this total crooked, deceptive, wicked system of belief, bringing that to earth. Meaning earth having a presiding deity, like in the afterlife. That's what they're really talking about, bringing heaven to earth. That's what they're talking about. They're talking about having like a single presiding deity over this planet instead of many, and then wiping out all other devotees, any other presiding deities, and they'll have a single presiding deity, and then everyone under that presiding deity, that presiding deity will have some special deal with God that with no more trauma on the planet, and we can all live in peace and harmony and forevermore, you know. That's just simply bringing the false idea of the afterlife, the false setup of the afterlife to this planet here, you know. Consolidating, you know, corporate shakeup, consolidation. Let's just have one presiding deity over the whole thing, and that one will then will be able to make a super deal with belief. Totally delusional. You know, those who are trying to bring heaven to earth are totally deluded still. They're hoping, you know, they're hoping that this will work, this deal will work. No, it will not. The only step that will work is to choose a new idea. That's it. No other step works. But you only need to make one step. So how difficult could that be? It's not like there's a million steps you need to take. On the path of belief, there's been millions and billions and trillions of steps we've already taken. So we assume that some other path will also mean trillions of steps, and we don't want to do that. No, it's only one step, one tiny step needs to be taken. That's it, choosing a new idea. That's all that needs to be done, one tiny step. But that step has to be taken. And this whole scheme of the afterlife and, you know, presiding deities and beautiful locations, etc., etc., trying to protect us from trauma, etc., believing that we can set that up here on this planet, and this planet will be like a trauma-free place, etc., etc., that doesn't change the system at all. It perpetuates it. Perpetuates it. That's not the remedy. You know, if you have one realm that, you know, you can stay in for a long time and before you get sent back into trauma, you're still going to be sent back into trauma. If the earth is made in some beautiful place where you can hang out supposedly in peace and freedom, you know, you're still going to be sent somewhere else into trauma. Eventually, you haven't broken free of delusion at all. You haven't seen through the scheme of belief at all. You haven't seen through its plan. You haven't recognized it's futile. You haven't recognized the price you're paying. It's just the time scale is being stretched and changed. You're just playing with time scales. That's all. That's all that existence does, is plays with time scales and deludes us into believing, you know, hey, we're finally free because we've got a different time scale here. We're not going to be sent back into trauma for thousands of years, so we're free. Nonsense. We're just as deluded as before, and maybe even more so. Because we're in this long delay pattern now, where for thousands of years we would not even worry about trying to see through belief. It makes it worse, really. Not to say that dwelling in a beautiful place is inherently, necessarily not helpful if you have the right orientation towards getting free of it, choosing a new idea. There's some way that, you know, there's some Passover principle where if you are willing to choose a new idea, the belief, you know, has to retreat from you and you can be left with a very peaceful scenario situation for you. Not to be deceived, though, that is actual, the end game. It's not the end game in itself. Okay. At some point, I'm going to end this video. It's October 27th. I got to give it my best, you know? This is the big day. October 27th is the big day. For me, it's always, that's the most important day of the year. This is where the big push, you know, happens. The big push. So this video has been a big push. You know, big push has given you a ton of stuff to consider. It's given you this massive gestalt to consider. It's given you the big picture and, you know, to consider. Just saying, wow, you know, I may not be, you know, there may be, you know, a way to disengage from this massive play of deception. It seems like there is a way. I don't have to keep getting trapped in this. You know, the temptations are here in the world, definitely. A lot of presiding deities in the subtle realms are incarnated at this time. A lot of them. A lot of them. And they can be very tempting, you know. So, and they're working on this scheme to turn this world into like an afterlife-like realm type of thing. And all of this is a complete waste of time. And you can recognize it's a waste of time, and you can choose a new idea, and you can get the benefits of that, which are endless, perfect benefits. All right. As we continue on here towards 3 hours. What time is it right now? I don't even know. Almost noon. I actually have to go to work today. It's a Saturday, but I didn't get enough hours in the week, so I have to go to work. And then there's a World Series game. I wish the Giants would hurry up and win it in 4, so I don't have to keep, you know, thinking about that at all. It's over with, done with, you know. Get it done. Get it done in 4 straight, and we can go on with more important situations for sure. And the question is, if you meet someone, are they a presiding deity or are they a genuine guru, you know? That is the question. Be able to determine the difference between the two is all important. Are they teaching, choose a new idea, and they're pointing out the futility of presiding deities and afterlife, dwelling in afterlife and all of that belief? Or are they some very attractive, charismatic presiding deity of some afterlife realm that has happened to have reincarnated here on this planet? See, that's the issue. That's the issue. That's a very important, that's a super important issue. Now, being aware of anandamayama, for me, I'm able to look at others and I say, it seems like they're actually a presiding deity of some afterlife loka, some realm. And they've incarnated here. And so they're not aware of truth. They're not aware of freedom. They believe that freedom is just that they've cut some special deal with belief, and that's their freedom. That's their happiness. Not true. That's generally the case here. Not always, but generally that's what you're looking at. But can a genuine, free, enlightened teacher of truth, of choosing a new idea, incarnate here? Can be, yeah, absolutely they can. They can come out of the subtle realms back into this more gross realm, for sure. It's all the same to them, really. This gross realm and the subtle realms, Anandamayi said, this world here, the gross world, and all the subtle, other subtle realms that she says she's visited, all those realms too, it's all the same to her, no difference. Because we said, wow, isn't this terrible being in this gross realm? She goes, no, there's no difference to me whatsoever, none. So sure, coming here for them is exactly the same as for them to be in the highest of subtlest of subtle realms of belief. Being here in this world is exactly the same to them. It's no inconvenience whatsoever compared relative to any other subtle realm, none. So we don't need to feel sorry for them. Anandamayi Ma was asked, you know, aren't you inconvenienced by being in this terribly gross, horrible, you know, non-subtle realm? Aren't you being irritated or upset or inconvenienced in any way? She says, no, not in the slightest bit. It's all exactly the same to me. No difference at all. None. And it's true. She was telling the truth. So we shouldn't feel guilty like if one of these truly liberated, enlightened beings comes here that has chosen a new idea or that is an ambassador of reality, comes here on this planet, comes into this gross, subtle realm of drama. We shouldn't feel sorry for them, because to them it's exactly the same. It's no different. They're not affected by it. And just, you know, welcome them and say, you know, great, glad you're here in this lowest, you know, the realms of belief. So, well, it's not the lowest or lower, that's for sure. There's more grosser realms, and a lot of people have come up from those grosser realms to incarnate on this planet too. You know, that's for sure. You know, you see those who are just, wow, where'd you come from? You must have come from some pretty, you know, nasty place, subtle afterlife realm. The afterlife has all these different places, from subtlest, beautiful to grossest, dark, ugly, you know. And they're actually all the same in relation to truth. They're all the same. They're all equally unreal. But there are those who come to this planet from very high, subtle realms, afterlife realms. And there are those who come from very, very dark, very violent, nasty afterlife realms also. And many have come from those places on this planet now. They're here. They want to, you know, cause mayhem here. That's what they're all about. Again, it's all the same dance of deception. That's the destructivity. Destructivity is here wanting to, you know, attack the protectiveness of those who are the subtler, nicer, subtler people, you know, have, and they're here to wipe them out. And a lot of those from the higher subtle realms don't even know why they're here, just that guilt pushed them back into this realm. And they don't realize that they're in the crosshairs of those from the lower realms who are going to inflict trauma upon them. They don't realize that. Now, they might have some subtle awareness like, uh-oh, I'm going to get traumatized here. That's bad. And those from the lower, subtler afterlife realms have reincarnated planet, and they are full of mayhem, absolutely mayhem. You can hear it in their music and their culture and everything, you know. Appetite for destruction is exactly what they have. And that those from the higher subtler realms get pushed down by the guilt of belief, saying you need to sacrifice yourself one more time to make the whole plan of salvation work. And so they're in the crosshairs of this destructivity. So, you know, it's the beautiful people, the good people, those who think they're really spiritual are very likely to be the ones who are going to get wiped out. The world will be full of their blood. Absolutely, because they were told by belief that they have to go through one more traumatic sacrifice in order to make the whole plan of belief work, which of course the plan of belief can't work, which means there is no need for any sacrifice, there's no need for any trauma, because the answer is to choose a new idea where there is no belief, no call for trauma whatsoever. So nobody has to be traumatized, no one. So all these, you know, subtle presiding deities who have been pushed back down by guilt to incarnate on this planet at this time, and all their devotees with them, say, being told that there's one more death, one more sacrifice will save everybody. That's a lie. They're being lied to by belief, and they don't have to go through it. Do not. They can all sidestep it. And of course, those who come here to be destroyed, they'll be gnashing their teeth and wailing and screaming like, ah, we want to tear them limb to limb, you know, and we can't, they escaped us. And they're saying, we can't be saved either, which is a lie too. They also are being lied to. They're being told that if they destroy these high presiding deities and devotees, that will save everyone. That will be what proves that there's this power threat that completes the super weapon to threaten reality and force reality. God, prime creator, to change reality and make us prime creator. They're told that. That's a lie too. Everybody's being lied to in belief. Everyone. The high presiding deities, the presiding deities of the high subtle realms, the presiding deities of the lower subtle realms and all their devotees, they're all being lied to. I mean, the lower realms, the brutal, traumatic realms of afterlife, have presiding deities too. The warlords, you know? And the Dakinis there of leading the destroyers into battle, you know? They do their battle cries and battle dances, you know, too, to get them going. Wielding the axes, you know, get them to wield the axes with great vigor. You know, they have warlords so those warlords incarnate on the planet along with their devotees that are believe that they're going to be saved if they just are able to follow the warlord successfully in the battle and to wipe out all the presiding deities of the higher realms, you know, that are incarnate here to be traumatized and wiped out. That's what's going on. That is what is going on. Everyone believing that if they just carry out their role in this, that everyone's going to be saved. That's what everyone believes. Total lie. It just perpetuates belief and makes it even more, you know, even more engaging with it. Thinking that we must be close, we must have that super weapon, must be almost finished, you know, maybe this will finish it. There is no super weapon. Reality cannot be threatened. All this is a waste of time, completely futile. Dance of deception is completely futile. Absolutely. Waste of everyone's time. Nobody has to incarnate. Nobody has to be vulnerable. No one has to try and protect vulnerability. Nobody has to attack that protection and wipe out the vulnerable. Nobody has to do any of this. Complete waste of time. The option is for all of us to choose a new idea. The idea of not trying to be crime creator. Acceptance of reality as it is. That is the remedy. Everyone can choose that remedy. Those from the lowest, afterlife realms who've super destructive, you know, come here to go berserk and inflict mayhem upon the whole planet. You know, they can choose that idea. They're just as capable as any, as the highest presiding deities of the subtlest, most beautiful afterlife realms. Just as capable. And the results will be exactly the same for both. No difference. So the idea that something has to be accomplished in belief is completely false. Nothing has to be accomplished in belief. Nothing has to be accomplished here at all. Everyone can choose a new idea right now. Nothing has to be accomplished in belief. Nothing real can be accomplished in belief anyway. Nothing in real will ever be accomplished. So you're not missing out on anything by choosing a new idea. This may be a lot to digest, but, you know, it can be digested. Absolutely can be digested. I'm digesting it right now. Not a problem. So God's grace can reach us within this belief system. We can be reached here. I've been reached, you see. There are those who are completely free from that, who are completely aware of it, and can come into this world, can incarnate here, and inform us of what's going on. The information can be written down in books, and it can be come from within. Clarity can come from within. All of those ways can reach us here. And we can be reached, and we can see through the totality of this deception. Even now, when the game is afoot, so much afoot where everybody feels it's the crucial time, we must not see this at all. We must go through with it. You know, even now, when the pressure to go through with it is so extreme and the Dakinis are warming up backstage, you know, to get out there and do their bikini go-go dance for everybody to get with the mayhem, either to get with the mayhem to inflict it or to accept it, you know. Both dances for both. Even now, we can see through the totality of it and reject it and laugh and say, ah, how ridiculous it is. It's completely ridiculous. The whole thing, from the highest realms of the afterlife to the lowest realms of the afterlife to the whole play here on this planet, dismiss it all with a laugh. It's all completely silly. Could see through it all. As one gestalt, you know, as one whole picture. See the totality of the picture. Frame doesn't even matter. You can see the entire picture. It's easy. It can be done even now. It can be done even now as the storm is about to strike. All right. This video is about to end. It's an enforced ending this time. Very soon. Because it's going to reach the 3-hour mark, which is the cutoff time for this this website. So we'll just wait here for that 3-minute ticking down. We're counting down now to about 10 seconds left. 9, 8, 7, 6, etc. All right, very great. Very, very great. We'll see what happens next. Huh? What happened next? Is it still recording? Wow.